meeting in 2014 of the Health and Sport Committee. As usual at this point, I'd ask everyone in the room to switch off mobile phones or other wireless devices. They can sometimes interfere with the sound system, of course, they can also disturb the meeting. I should also ask those attending to note that some members and officials are using tablet devices, which is instead of the hard copies of their papers. I have apologies this morning from the Net Milling, and I welcome Jackson Carlow once again as the Conservative Party substitute. Our first item on the agenda today is our inquiry into early years, which is part of a themed work on health inequalities. And can I welcome to the committee Sir Harry Burns, Professor of Global Public Health, University of Strathclyde. Welcome once again. And also Professor Michael Marmot, University College London, Institute of Health Equity. Welcome to you both, gentlemen. Can I offer you the opportunity to make a few brief remarks, Professor Martin?
Thank you. Firstly, if Harry Burns is an adequate reflection of what's happening in Scotland on health inequalities, then Scotland leads the world. So you don't really need me because you've got Harry Burns. Certainly, his views and mine accord very well. If I could just, by way of introduction, make a few brief points. The first is that when people think about health inequalities, commonly they think about the health of the poor. And indeed, the poor do have poor health. That's part of the story. But the real challenge for all of us is the gradient. The fact is that people near the top have worse health than those at the top. People in the middle have worse health than those near the top. And that applies to every marker of good early child development, given that we're talking about children. If you look at children's physical development growth, look at children's cognitive development, linguistic development, social and emotional development, it's a gradient. Look at performance in school by the socioeconomic characteristics of their parents or the area in which they live, it's a gradient. The lower the socioeconomic level, the worse the performance. And I would say that looking at the UK, Scotland and England and Wales and Northern Ireland, we do pretty badly globally among OECD countries in markers of early child development and school performance, which means that if we want to do better globally, we've got to address not just the poor performance of those at the bottom, we've got to address the gradient. I was in Sweden last week. I could probably say that almost any week. The Swedes are very enthusiastic. And a Swedish television interviewer said to me, last time I interviewed you, you told me a story about an economist in Her Majesty's Treasury. When I showed him a graph of the gradient, he said, and the Swedish interviewer remembered this, oh, don't come to me with that Scandinavian nonsense. We're Anglo-Saxons here, he said. We focus, in fact, he was Irish-Jewish, but never mind. We focus on the worst off, he said. That's the default position of British social policy. We focus on the worst off. And this Scandinavian nonsense is not for us. She said, is that still the case? I said, well, and this is my second point, we're trying to get the message of proportionate universalism across. And by that I mean the gradient suggests that we need universalist policies, policies for everybody. A health service for the poor is a poor health service. An education system for the poor is a poor education system. What we want is people to have the entitlements to be part of the mainstream, to bring people in to universalist systems, be it education, healthcare, or society in general. But we may need to have effort proportionate to need, and hence the proportionate universalism. In the health service, we don't spend the same amount of effort on everybody. I'd be perfectly happy if, despite paying tax all my life, I never used the health service. That I feel that would be a great deal because it meant I was well. But if I had diabetes and dementia and peripheral vascular disease, I'd want a lot of expenditure of the health service. And it's a universal service. We expend proportionate to need. So the first is the gradient. The second is proportionate universalism. The third point I wanted to make is, well, what can the health service do? If you're a health and sport committee, what can the health service do, given that the key drivers lie outside the healthcare system of good early child development and child health? And we produced, my Institute of Health Equity produced a report asking the question of what can health and medical organizations do. And we suggested there were five things: education and training, treating the patient in his or her broader context, so you don't just hand out the pills to the person in front, you recognize the broader context that brought them there. The third is the health service as employer, and related to early childhood, of course, that relates to the work-life balance. The fourth is working with others, partnership working. And again, for early childhood, that's key, working with other services who have as their main domain early childhood. And the fifth is advocacy. As a doctor, I'm a doctor, I've taken the line, going back to Virchow in the 19th century, doctors are the natural attorneys of the poor. And we in the medical profession should be the advocates for improved conditions that will improve the conditions of the worst off. If I may, the fourth thing I want to say is the importance of monitoring. I think monitoring is absolutely vital, and I know in Scotland you understand that very well, and are leading the pack in developing good monitoring. We in the Institute of Health Equity, for example, were commissioned to produce a report on monitoring in early childhood, and we said you've got to monitor the children, early child development, parenting, the parents with mental illness, with little education themselves and so on, that influences their ability for good parenting, and fourthly, the context in which parenting takes place. I've been looking at child poverty before and after taxes and transfers. If we look at OECD countries in Europe, in the United Kingdom, we have, I think, the highest pre-tax child poverty level, where poverty is defined as less than 60% median income. Post-tax, the figures are really very interesting. If you look at a country like Sweden and Latvia, pre-tax, their child poverty levels 35% in Latvia, 32% in Sweden. Post-tax, Latvia is 25% child poverty, Sweden is 12%. Regrettably, the United Kingdom looks more like Latvia than it does like Sweden. Slovenia, not a rich country, has even lower child poverty levels than Sweden post-tax. Ours are above 20%. After taxes and transfers. So that decision by the Chancellor, Department of Work and Pensions, is affecting the quality of early child development. What the Chancellor does probably has more impact on the quality of early childhood than what the Minister of Health does. And the last thing, if I may, I made a pilgrimage to a Finnish school. I'm not the first to go and pray at the shrine of Finnish education, question is, why does Finland always do best at in the PISA scores, the Programme of International Student Assessment, of any European country? Not quite as well as Korea and Shanghai, but the best of the European countries. What are they doing? And what they do in the schools is very interesting. But one of the key points the head teacher made to me is you cannot divorce what goes on in the school from what goes on in the wider society. She argued that Finnish schools do really well with relatively small social gradients in outcome of education because this is a reflection of Finnish society. And this is a way of saying that if you want to improve early child development and inequalities in early child development, you need to look to the wider society. It's not a matter simply of having technical interventions.
Thank you. Professor Burns?
You know, I hadn't intended to make any opening statement because I think colleagues around the table know exactly where I'm coming from. I've spoken about this before. But just to make a couple of points. First thing to say is that 20 years ago, when I was first appointed Director of Public Health in Glasgow, one of the first people I went to see was Sir Michael, because, and ever since then, he's been scientifically the fount of terrific advice for me, and I think where I've got to owes a lot to the work that he's done over the years. I think in the last few years, where we have moved ahead in Scotland has been in methods for change. I now find myself also going a lot to Scandinavian countries, to southern European countries, because they are really interested in how Scotland is beginning to tackle the problem. The realisation really came from the fact that while lots of studies have shown specific indicated specific issues that needed to be changed, the method for change has always eluded us. We still think in terms of a machine metaphor here, that there is a lever you pull here that makes everything all right over there, and society ain't like that. It's a complex system and it needs different ways of dealing with it. And what we have adopted is a very inclusive approach that we've borrowed from improvement science that has worked so effectively in the patient safety programme. It's not the finished article. I wouldn't claim that what we're doing is absolutely perfect, but the point is it's been co-produced across the whole of the system. As Sir Michael has just said, you can't divorce, you cannot identify a single issue that is the cause of the inequalities problem we have in early years. We need to be tackling the complex system that is society. That means parenting, it means supporting parents who really don't know how to be parents and helping them understand the way ahead. It means giving young people who become alienated from school. I mean, I keep going on about the fact that young people who have difficult early lives become have a much higher risk of mental illness, they have a much higher risk of behaviour problems. So what does our school system do? We exclude them from school. Completely the wrong thing to do. Alienation throughout life, the young people who become excluded from school have a high risk of going to jail, they have a high risk of never working again. And throughout life, we need to take a life course view, we need to take a pan-societal view that allows younger people to grow and to remain integrated and to be part of society. So we have adopted an approach that seems to allow us to begin to co-produce with other agencies in society and with people themselves and communities the solutions to some of these problems. I mean, I know from reading previous minutes of the committee that people are anxious to know, is it working? Is it, you know, are things moving in the right direction? Well, it'll take some time. But what we mustn't do is chop and change. If we feel that we're on the right track, we need to stick with it. Some years ago, I helped a colleague in Glasgow go off to America for a year with a Harkness Fellowship, and he examined a lot of the early years programmes that had been set up under President Johnson, who had a big interest in early years. And what he said was that the early years produced very significant improvement. Early years interventions like preschool education and so on produced very significant improvements in outcome, but most of those improvements weren't obvious until the children were in their mid-teens. By then, they were not getting drunk, they were not getting involved in crime, they were staying on at school, they were finishing high school, they were getting into jobs, and the return on investment began to rack up at that time. Now, again, I would argue that economic reasons aren't the prime reasons for doing this. This is an issue of justice and fairness and doing the right thing because it's the right thing to do. But the fact is, it makes sense for everybody in society to support this kind of approach. So I would claim that we're ahead of the game in Scotland in terms of our approach to this with things like the Early Years Collaborative. We need to build on that and extend it. And the Scottish Prison Service are using some of these techniques in Polmont and so on, where they now call Polmont not a young offenders institution, but they're trying to see it as an educational establishment, which I think has to be a great leap forward. We need to join up all the good work that's being done and make a movement out of it. And my previous job in the civil service did not allow me to advocate, to be an advocate in the traditional sense of the word, but that's what I'm going to do now, advocacy for this kind of approach. Thank you.
Thank you both. I think our first question is from Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Can I say, gentlemen, good morning, and I welcome and agree with all the comments you've made. At the end of the day, whilst the state shouldn't be a big brother, we could actually start to help people as their children are born, and educate them right through the system. And in fact, I would say what we do for our children today affects their future tomorrow. But can I turn to the point, and Professor Marmot touched on it, and in his 6 points, and basically one of the points you made in regards to child poverty. Child Poverty Action Group has estimated that over 100,000 children in Scotland may be pushed into poverty as a result of UK welfare reforms. You actually said in October last year that the UK was failing too many of our children, women and young people on a grand scale, and that in the UK we have chosen to have a relatively high child poverty rates, and you went on about the Chancellor in your opening statement, and you said it was a policy choice. What do you believe are the policy choices that have driven this increase in child poverty, and what do you expect to happen in the coming years?
The policy choice, the reason I referred to these comparisons among OECD countries by saying that some countries are clearly intolerant of high levels of child poverty. I mean, there are no countries that get below 10%. I mean, that's kind of statistical. If it's less than 60% median income, it's unlikely that you'll have a distribution of zero with no child poverty. So the lowest is Norway with 10% after taxes and transfers. But that's a benchmark. That's something we could choose to do. We could choose in the United Kingdom, in Scotland, England and the other parts, we could choose to be more like Slovenia. Wow, what a name. We should be like one of the fractured bits of the former Yugoslavia in terms of our social and economic policy. Now, I mean, I won't go into all the details. You probably know them better than I. But, I mean, if you look at the data from the Institute of Fiscal Studies on the changes to the tax and benefit system by deciles of income, the top decile gets a drop because the 50% tax rate kicked in and now it's 45%, but gets a drop. But for every decile below the top one, the lower the starting income, the greater the decline in income as a result of the operation of the tax and benefit system. That is a political choice. That's a political choice. So it's a choice that's been made that the worst of should suffer more. in terms of percent decline, and that the lower you are, the greater the drop. That's a political choice. And I've been very careful never, I think, to make party political comments in public. I analyse the data. I analyse the evidence. And I point out that's a political choice. Now, if the Chancellor says, I'm very happy with that choice, that's my choice, and that's the way I choose to do it, absolutely fine. But I feel the responsibility to say that will damage our children. And talking in the US, I showed them the figures in the US. The US, after taxes and transfers, is worse than Latvia in terms of child poverty. And I looked at 7,000 public health people that I was addressing at the American Public Health Association. I said, you live in a democracy. Democrat, Republican, I couldn't care less. This must be the level of child poverty you want. Otherwise, you'd elect a government that did something different. You're damaging the next generation. And it's got worse. So that's what I mean by political choices. This is a political choice. When I heard the Prime Minister say over the floods, money is no object, and I thought, why wouldn't he say that about child poverty? Floods are terrible, but so is child poverty. Child poverty is like a flood. It's like a natural disaster. And we could take government action to reduce it. And I think, arguing from a health point of view, we should.
So you're neither a Democrat or a Republican. What different policy choices would you make to reverse this change?
The theme running through the three reviews that I've done, the WHO Commission on Social Determinants of Health, the Marmot Review of Health Inequalities in England, and now the European Review of Social Determinants and the Health Divide, is to put health equity at the heart of all policy making. The filter I would run over all policy making is the impact on health equity. People have asked me, in a way like you've asked me, what would you do if you were Chancellor of the Exchequer? And I said, I think it's a great benefit to the people of Britain that I'm not Chancellor of the Exchequer, and I'm really pleased that I'm not. So I can argue that let's put the likely impact on health equity at the heart of all policy making. And if something makes child poverty worse, I wouldn't do it. I would actually run that filter over my policy making and make sure that nothing that I did would make child poverty worse.
I see Harry Burns want to come in through you. Can you?
Well, to absolutely agree with what Sir Michael has said, but to make the point that this isn't just about equity in health, this is about equity in attainment. We've had the publicity about differential attainment at school. If we really want a future generation to be delivering intellectually, to be innovative, to be creative and so on, we've got to give them the best start in life. And the damage that is done, we know from the studies that we've carried out in Glasgow but have been carried out internationally, the damage that is done is physical damage that limits the capacity of young children to learn and to behave appropriately in complex situations. Very powerful evidence for that. The more adversity that young children experience in early life, the more likely they are to become alcoholics, to become drug addicts, to become violent, and so on. Cast iron, longitudinal studies. Why would we not want to prevent that happening? So it's we're talking about health today, but this is across the whole of society that we would benefit. And in Victorian times, it was often said that major public health interventions only really occurred when the children of the rich were being damaged. You know, damaged by the infectious diseases and tuberculosis. That gave the people at the top of the social tree a reason to be concerned. Well, I think across the whole of society, we're all losing out because talent and ability in young children is not being given the opportunity to flourish. So we should be concerned.
Thank you.
We've had quite considerable evidence and, you know, written evidence to us about the policy rich agenda that we have, but the poor delivery. I think it's, you know, why haven't we delivered, I suppose, is the question. We see from the papers and recent news this week that looked after children in Scotland has increased by 49% since 2001. We see that children on the child protection register has flatlined since 2008 in Scotland, and the UK has got the worst rates of excess child mortality in Western Europe, and Scotland is even worse. How do we use this proportionate universalism to create action in these areas? Because, you know, we're talking about children dying of poverty on the child mortality figures recently, just last week. You know, so, you know, between that and that gradient, you know, I mean, I hear what you say, that there's got to be a broad thrust here. But how do we stop and change those figures that have been present since I raised them in 2009?
I gave evidence in Westminster, in the Parliament, following my English review. And I showed a graph. We've been monitoring early child development, but it would be harder to do for mortality, because even though our figures are shockingly bad, happily, there's still not many child deaths, so you can't monitor at local levels because there aren't many child deaths. But monitoring early child development, looking at the degree of deprivation of the local authority, it shows the gradient. So you plot 150 local authorities graded by degrees of affluence or deprivation, and you see the proportion of children aged 5 classified as having good level of development goes up progressively the more affluent the local authority. And some sportsman in the audience, not a member of parliament, said the proportion of variance explained in that graph would be quite low. And I thought, it's just what members of parliament want to hear about, a discussion about multiple R squared and correlations. So I tried to translate his comment into English. What he was saying was that there was spread around the line. And the reason I'm making a point of this is it suggests there has to be two strategies. The first is flatten the socioeconomic gradient. The degree of inequality, social and economic inequality, is very large, and child development follows that gradient in social and economic circumstances. So bring the social and economic circumstances of the worst off up towards the middle, and you'll flatten the gradient in early child development. But the second strategy, given that there's variation around the line, it suggests for a given level of deprivation, some local areas are doing better than others. Aha, that's very important. I went to Birmingham, and Birmingham's been in bad news lately, the early child services. But I went to Birmingham because they had, they told me, 6 Marmot champions, one for each of the 6 domains of recommendations I made in my review. And I got out their figures on early child development. Birmingham is more deprived than England on average, and their early child development scores are worse than England on average. And over 3 years, they completely closed the gap between Birmingham and England. Now, they didn't close the gap in deprivation in 3 years, but they closed the gap in early child development. So it suggests two strategies. One is it's going to be very hard for Scotland or the rest of the United Kingdom to catch up as long as we have the level of social and economic inequalities that we have. And they're getting worse. We were talking everywhere I've been lately. I talk about Piketty's book on capital in the 21st century. It's getting worse in France. It's getting worse in the United States. It's getting worse in the UK. Not in all countries, but the inequalities are getting worse. And it's going to be very hard for Scotland, England, Wales, Northern Ireland to make progress in the face of the increasing inequalities. But there is a second strategy. which is take the best evaluated programs, and there are good evaluated programs that really do improve early child development, and we've not been doing that systematically. I don't know the Scottish scene, but I do know in England, Sure Start centres have been closing. Sure Start children's centres have been closing. Local authorities are strapped for cash. I was in Newcastle recently. They're not despondent. They're trying to make do with the hand that they've been dealt. But when they're dealing with 24% cuts, local authority, they said very soon the only things we'll be doing in Newcastle are those things that for which we have statutory responsibility and nothing else. I was in Manchester. They're giving me the same story. Again, they're doggedly pushing on, but in the face of huge cuts. So to start closing Sure Start children's centres in the face of increasing inequality, social and economic inequalities, it's not a mystery why we're not doing as well as we might.
So, Professor Burns.
Yeah. I think we are doing a lot through the Early Years Collaborative, Family Nurse Partnership, Positive Parenting Plan, very much focused on young teenagers having children, and this whole philosophy of nobody wants to be a bad parent, they just don't know how to be a good parent, is at the heart of a lot of these interventions. So I think we're managing to maintain that at the moment, and we will, I think, in the course of the next year, begin to see significant impacts on markers of child development. I hope that's the case. I think there is a much you ask why have we not made a difference. I think there's a number of reasons. The first is that the analysis of inequalities has moved on a lot over the past 2 or 3 years. If you define inequality in economic terms, then you automatically assume that the solutions are economic, and it's no doubt part of the solution is, but to make sure that you tackle child poverty is necessary but not sufficient on its own. There's a whole set of cultural things that we have to do differently. Jerry Hassan's new book talks about Scotland's problem is empathy, lack of empathy and connectedness and so on. The analysis that the Glasgow Centre for Population Health has done in its comparison of Glasgow, Liverpool and Manchester, the three cities are the same in terms of inequality and average income, but they differ significantly in terms of their causes of premature death. And the one set of indicators that is completely different between the three cities are indicators of empathy and connectedness. Glaswegians are far less likely to trust their neighbours. We asked them, 1,000 people in each city, if you lost a purse or a wallet, did you think that it would be handed in by your neighbour? And you're far less likely to say yes in Glasgow than in Liverpool or Manchester. And I went down, Glaswegians are far less likely to be a member of a club, they're far less likely to volunteer, they're far less likely to go to church, they're far less likely to be part of a community, a definable community. And one of my close friends in public health at the time was the Director of Public Health for Liverpool. And in fact, she lived in Manchester, so she knew the two cities well. And I presented these figures to her, and immediately her response was, that's easy to understand because people in Liverpool feel well supported. There was a fundamental difference in the sense of community in Liverpool. And since then, I've spent a lot of time in Liverpool. I'm a visiting professor at one of the universities in Liverpool. And there is no doubt there is a palpable difference in terms of the sense of community. And when you ask them, how did that come about? Amazingly, one of the things that they hear often was the leadership produced by the churches, particularly Archbishop Shepherd and Archbishop Warlock. There's a statue in the centre of Liverpool, two statues of these two men, and they're holding their hands out to each other. And there's footsteps in the pavement alongside it. And every time you go past it, someone is standing in those footsteps with these two men getting their photograph taken. The other way it's described to me is, Liverpool and Everton supporters are really good friends, actually. They don't care who beats Manchester United. there is a sense, a stronger sense of community down there than there is in some of the parts of Scotland that we see. So part of this challenge is not just about pulling a set of policy levers, but it's about creating a sense of community and a sense of compassion for people. I listened to Amartya Sen, Nobel Prize winning economist, give a lecture a couple of months ago, and the lecture was entitled Poverty and the Toleration of the Intolerable. And his analysis as to why societies like India and so on tolerate extremes of poverty was not because there was nothing they could do about it, there's plenty they can do about it, not because they didn't care about it, but because the middle classes didn't understand how destructive policy was. We lived with people, we know they're poor, but we don't actually, well, they get free schools and they get a free health service and all that kind of thing, so it can't be that bad. Well, what his argument was, yes, it is very destructive, and we have the evidence that shows extreme poverty changes the way babies' brains develop. It's as definable as that. We now have evidence that shows that chaotic early life changes the way genes are expressed. The whole science of epigenetics is beginning to throw up how the seeds of chronic disease in later life are laid down not just by your experience as a child, but by your parents' experience as a child. Big studies in Scandinavia that show that adverse nutritional circumstances in grandparents at the turn of the 19th to 20th century are still being shown in the grandchildren. So the biological consequences of social adversity are defined and profound. And the way to deal with that is to deal with the social adversity. And we don't just deal with the social adversity by changing the way taxes are distributed. Necessary, but not sufficient. We need to go much further and change the ethos in our society. You go to places like Holland, and no doubt Alan will talk about this later, you go to places like Scandinavia, their attitudes to children are completely different. They don't exclude children from school. My daughter, who spent a year, before going to university, she spent a year teaching in a school in Spain. Every morning, her 5 and 6-year-old children would line up at the door of the classroom and give her a kiss and a hug before they went into class. Culturally, teachers would run a mile from that kind of thing here. We do not show children care and empathy. And it's high time we did.
I look forward to that future discussion on biology and genetics at the committee here. I don't know if we'll go there. But it does seem to indicate that health is important, because we're going to be dealing with mitigation for a long time rather than the game changer.
The health service runs very hard and fast to deal with the consequences of inadequate investment in children. You know, we've spoken, last time I was down here, it was with the audit committee who were looking at the Auditor General's report on the way the health service puts money into health inequalities. Health service is spending tons of money dealing with the consequences. We need to spend our money more wisely in early years, and that way, I mean, a looked after child. Someone was telling me recently, an academic from England, that says that a looked after child will cost society about £2 million by the time he's reached his 20s, in terms of a variety of things like the consequences of offending, the consequences of mental health and so on. We've got far too many looked after children as a result of dysfunctionality in families where the parents don't know how to be parents.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant, followed by Bob Dorris.
My question, I guess, follows on quite well from that. It's about, I mean, I'm listening to what you're saying about all the different aspects involved in this, but about parenting, I suppose, is the one where we're talking about kind of social and economic issues being really important. But I think it was Professor Marmot who said that actually, you know, parenting can be important. But then if the curve goes like that, is that saying that people with more money are better parents? You know, where does this all fit in, I guess? And how do we tackle parenting for people maybe second or third generation who have never had experience within their families of parenting? And I suppose added on to that, sorry, I'm kind of coming out with a load of things, that things that are successful, like the family nurse partnership, are targeted at a very small number of people, hugely expensive and probably sucking resources out of other interventions such as health visiting and that supports a wider community. How do we, I suppose, take the benefits of those things without damaging others? And how do we roll that out? Sorry.
Well, if I could start, I like to talk from evidence, so when I'm making it up, I signal that I'm making it up. What I'm about to say now, I'm making up. No evidence at all, but then I'll go back to the evidence. What I'm going to make up is I think we are biologically programmed to be good parents. The species wouldn't have survived if parents didn't look after their offspring. So this, my speculation is that we're biologically programmed to be good parents. We get pushed off that track by circumstances. That if we weren't pushed off the track by circumstances, then we would naturally know how to nurture children. That you don't need to teach rhesus macaque monkeys how to be good mothers. They just do it. It turns out that some rhesus macaques are not good mothers, and mostly that's because of the way they were reared. You can do the experiment, and you rear rhesus monkeys with peers rather than with their mothers, so they don't have the experience of good mothering. When they grow up, they turn out to be terrible mothers. But if you take one of these, the offspring of one of these terrible mothers, and rear the offspring with a good mother, she turns out to be a supermum. So even if there's some inherited biological program, you can get them back on the right track by good circumstances. So now coming back to humans and back to where the evidence is, I think, it's tricky terrain. I had one woman stand up and say, that man Marmot is saying that I'm a bad mother because I'm poor. It's a bit confronting. I thought she was remarkably well informed. I didn't know how poor she really was, if she'd been reading my reports, but never mind. But it's a bit confronting because the evidence shows that if you look at parenting activities, reading to children, talking to children, playing with children, singing with children, all those parenting activities follow the social gradient. The lower the income quintile, the less input you get of all those good things from parents. But the evidence also shows, and evidence from France, and it's a nice example of proportionate universalism, if you have universally available preschool services, the kids from more middle-class backgrounds don't benefit very much because they're getting it from home. The less they're getting from home, the more they benefit from these universally available preschool services. So where parents are not playing, singing, talking, reading, doing all those things, and parents who are depressed, parents who are ground down by misery and poverty, are less likely to do those things. You might think that an unemployed parent, what else have they got to do but do those things for their children? They do it much less. The famous Kansas study on the 30 million words that everybody cites, the families on welfare speak to their children less than when two parents are working outside the home. Somehow they manage to address more words to their children than the families who are not working. So being unemployed is not great for child development, and it's not great for the well-being of the people who are unemployed. But services can make a difference. And that service may be helping parents be good parents, as Harry was saying, helping parents be good parents. It may be making up the lack. Coming back to Harry's point, the evidence that we compiled for the European review is if you look by country, the greater the proportion of children who spent at least 1 year in preschool education, the better that country performs on PISA scores at age 15 and 16. So, in other words, good preschool education is not just good for early child development, it's actually good for educational performance a dozen years later. So I think we can help parents be better parents, and I think we can fill in the gap with professional services where that's not possible.
I would bet you, if we looked at the family tree of every person in this room, back at 1, 2, 3 generations, we would find families living in poor circumstances. In every case, something happened that allowed someone in our families to make the leap forward. In my case, it was my father. My grandfather was a miner in Lochgelly in the 1920s, and my father left school aged 15 to go washing bottles in a lemonade factory, and he was there for 2 or 3 days, and a teacher from his school appeared, put his arm around him and said, "You're coming back to school, son." My father ended up with degrees in physics, mechanical engineering, chemical engineering, built secret weapons during the war, helped build the hydrogen bomb after the war and things like that.
Are you
know.
Proud of this?
No, I'm not proud of this. But the point was that he did quite significant things in his life, starting off from washing bottles in a lemonade factory, and a teacher made the difference. The point is that poverty does not condemn you to failure. And we all know of the positive deviance. And one of the interesting things that I think the research community will start to look at as we begin to get data sets that allow us to see why some children succeed when many of their fellows will fail, that's going to be the really interesting set of studies over the next few years. But we know a lot about why some children succeed, and it's about that kind of inclusion. Instead of them drifting off away from a path to success, someone sticks their neck out and says, "We want to help you." And we need to do far more of that. That needs to become the culture. I think that this question of the richer you are, the more you're likely to succeed well. Some very wealthy young children are going to be spectacular failures, and we see them on the front pages of the newspapers all the time. So it's about events that knock people off course. But having said that, the key thing is that the wealthier you are, the greater control you have over your life, and it's that notion of control. If you're worrying about being sanctioned by DWP and the bedroom tax and the drug pushers that are trying to lead your children off the straight and narrow and so on, other people control your life. You're not in control, and that lack of control has consequences for your health as well as your children's. The more control you have over your life, the more likely you are to succeed, the more likely you are to be healthier, and the richer you are, the more control you have over your life. I mean, I'm thinking about the days when I used to take my children skiing. It was a real trackle. You know, you flew to wherever it was, and you had the skis, and you had the passports, and all that. You know. When my son went to Oxford, one of his friends would go skiing in the private jet, and he would fly straight to the ski resort because Daddy had fixed that up with the passport authorities. Didn't go, you know. The rich live a very different life from the poor, and the rich live a very different life from the middle classes. They are much more in control of their lives, and that's the difference.
Sorry, Roddy, you have other questions?
Yes, I was just kind of on the back of some of the things you'd said there about, you know, people making interventions different. I suppose that then comes back to everyone who has a role in a child's life has a parenting role, because they can make an intervention. And there was also something you said earlier about, you know, the Spanish school where they all line up and give the teacher a kiss in the morning, which to us is absolutely alien, but I think it will be alien to most people that work with children, because all of child protection legislation and guidance tells you do not touch a child. And I always think looked after children never get any affection from anybody. And that must impact on their mental well-being.
It does. I had a conversation with a German who worked with looked after children, and what he said was he was shocked by our attitude in Scotland. If someone in a children's home walked past a room one night and heard a child sobbing here, he wouldn't be allowed to do anything about it. In Germany, you would go in and you'd comfort the child. It was natural, it was a normal way of doing things. And we have to rethink empathy. Children learn empathy very early on in their lives, and if empathy is what's missing across Scottish society, the sooner we start to spread that in as prudent a way as possible, the better. But we're not going to raise a society of people who care for each other if we demonstrate to children that we don't actually care for them.
Doris, and followed by Gil Parr.
Thanks, Convener. I find it really fascinating, the information that's been put on the record. Sir Harry, I think you'd probably expect me to just say something very briefly about representing Glasgow. You made a comment about Glasgow. What I'd written down had actually written community spirit versus community empowerment. In my experience, Glasgow has community spirit and shovel loads, but quite often what it doesn't have is community empowerment. And those are two very different dynamics. And I could give very detailed public policy decisions at a very local level where communities have felt completely disempowered, whether it's school closures or something else, but I won't dwell on that. I just thought it was important to say in my day-to-day activities as an MSP in Glasgow, I see bag loads of community spirit, but I don't always see a lot of community empowerment. But it's there and it's growing. I closed my community, I thought it was important to say for my constituents. I wanted to come to that figure about 100,000 children being pushed into poverty because of austerity and because of welfare cuts. And I don't actually want to dwell on the UK politics of it all. I want to look beyond that. I think people know what my views of that are. I don't think it's particularly helpful for this committee for me to elaborate on that any further. But let me give you a specific story. And I give this story a lot, and it is a brief one, Convener. It's about a single parent who was working in a part-time job, desperate to work, was pushed into unemployment because of tax credit reforms at a UK level. So there you have a single parent in a working household now on welfare. So now whether that person would then count as part of that 100,000 people being pushed into poverty or not, I'm not sure. But the gradient of poverty that both Professor Marmot and Sir Harry was talking about cuts right across all income groups, and those 100,000 people who are, if you like, falling down that prosperity scale and becoming more impoverished, do they have to be targeted specifically, or will they be caught by universal services when we seek to support them? In other words, if you're pushed into the same poverty to what will become your new peer group, so you weren't poor, you are now poor, you're in the same poverty as others who have been there intergenerationally, Should you just be caught by the same universal service, or is there the need for targeting there? And is there a danger of consigning that family to similar intergenerational poverty and poor health outcomes? I hope that's not too abstract, but I'm just trying to work out how we can identify where these families are, who they are, and how we can have a useful intervention to benefit their lives, or else 100,000 just becomes a number, but these are actually individuals and families across Scotland.
Well, if I could start, firstly, just to pick up a theme that's been touched on. The implication of what Thomas Piketty has said, and the reason he's become a rock star overnight, is publishing a book by Harvard University Press. It's a bit unusual to be a bestseller, but never mind, is that I think one of the reasons is that what he's saying is that the gap between the 1% and the middle is expanding at a frightening rate. It's not just the worst off versus the middle, it's the best off versus the middle. And in the US, for men in full-time employment, the bottom 80% of the distribution has had virtually no improvement over a 25-year period. And between 2010 and 2012, of all the economic improvement that happened in the US, 95% out of every dollar of economic improvement, 95 cents went to the top 1%. So we're talking, and given that I've been pushing the idea of the gradient for 30 years, 35 years, this is music to my ears. The idea that we should stop thinking only about the people at the bottom, as I said right at the beginning, that's very important that people are missing out. But we're all in danger of missing out to a degree, all of us below the top 1%, the gap. And talking to, doesn't matter who it was, but a very prominent doctor in the US who said, I'm really worried about social unrest. People are really angry and getting very upset. The middle is getting very angry and very upset because it's not delivering for them. So to come back then more specifically to your question about should we be targeting or should we be universal, well, I don't think we should be targeting the bottom 99%. That's a universal service. I don't think we should be targeting the bottom half. That's a universal service. If the middle are in danger of falling below the poverty line, that, it seems to me, reinforces the idea, the need for proportionate universalism. It means that we need universal services. And this is part to come back to the original question that you asked me. If you look at UK figures, now it's a small majority, but the majority of people in poverty are in households where at least one person works. And in those households where at least one person works, three quarters of the adults are working. The problem with poverty is not that people are shirking, it's because they're not paid enough. They're low paid. Which means that we taxpayers, my taxpayers' money, is subsidising employers to take on low-paid staff. It's okay, don't pay them very much, and we, the taxpayer, will make up the difference. We'll give them housing benefits, we'll give them tax credits, we'll try and give them enough so they can just about buy enough food or heat the house. And as we know, the choice is between heating and eating. We did a report on fuel poverty. And that's the people in work. And most people don't think of the people in work as poor. They think of the poor as not working. But the majority of people who are now below an income threshold of poverty are in work. I think we've got to be much more broad, dare I say it, radical, in rethinking how we want to organise our affairs as a society. What sort of society are we running when people who are working, these mythical hard-working families we keep hearing about all the time, aren't earning enough to have a healthy life? And then we worry about their children. Well, I worry about their children. Sir Harry worries about their children. But I also worry about the circumstances in which they're raising their children. So my response to your question is we really do need not just proportionate universalism, we need a much broader approach to how we use our considerable wealth as a society.
I would absolutely agree with all of that and add to it the need to care for the individual. I think that we have this network of services, we have this approach that that we would describe as evolving out of a caring society, but individuals find themselves in individual difficulties. And on top of that, we need to be able to mount some kind of connectedness that allows us, whether it's through the voluntary sector or whether it's through statutory agencies. I mean, my bias is always towards the voluntary sector because statutory agencies have rules. You know, we have child protection rules and all that kind of thing, whereas volunteers are there because they want to be there, because they care, not because they're paid to be there. And people who find specific difficulties, who have a specific drug or alcohol problem that's interfering, who have a domestic violence problem, who have some kind of mental health issue or whatever, they're going to need specific help. And I mean, I'm not about to propose some new set of services or anything that can do this, but we need to be more compassionate. We need to, you know, I suggested once to the Permanent Secretary that perhaps a good way of moving forward would be to allow one day a week for every civil servant to volunteer. Now, maybe one day a week's maybe pushing it a bit far, but if we all took some part in volunteering, it would show us just how bad the lives of some people are. And having recognised that, I think it would create a movement. It would allow us to move Scotland as a society in a much more caring direction. That's what it's going to take. You're not going to be able to fix this. You can go a long way in this Parliament in enacting legislation and policies and so on that will help support it, but at the end of the day, it's about people looking after each other. And we don't do that nearly enough in this society, and we've got data to show that.
Okay. Convener, there's lots more questions I want to ask, but my fellow committee members want in, so hopefully there'll be time later for me to pursue some more of this, so I can see other members wishing to get in just now.
Okay, Gil Patterson.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm getting a wee bit confused. My mind, there's a contradiction I'm getting from your contribution, and maybe you can help clear it up. Sir Harry is saying that intervention, the prospect intervention, can solve the problem. That's what I'm hearing. But the gradient that Professor Marriott suggests is that the Chancellor, his actions, can stop the intervention needing to be taken place in the first place. That's what I'm gathering, that that by his tax methods, he can cause a problem to start in the first place.
No, I didn't. I'm sorry if I wasn't clear. I said that there are two strategies. One is to reduce the level of social and economic inequalities, and I said for a given level of deprivation, some communities are doing better than others. And I cited the example of Birmingham, right, that had closed the gap between Birmingham and England in early child development without reducing the level of poverty or deprivation. So I didn't say this is just for the Chancellor. The evidence shows very clearly that good quality parenting, and where good quality parenting is not happening, we can support it with good quality services, can make a difference. So that these are not either or. It's not, we'll just leave it all to the Chancellor and it'll all be fine. Children need good quality parenting or support from others in that parenting role. No question about it. They need that hands-on. I mean, think about reading to children. What does reading to children do, apart from send the parent to sleep? Wake up, Daddy. Come on, wake up. What does reading to children do? It gives them cognitive stimulation. It gives them literary stimulation, cuddling, warmth, care. I mean, it's everything. And the Chancellor can't deliver that. Not even our present Chancellor could deliver that.
He's very cuddly.
So whatever the Chancellor does doesn't take away from the need for children to be cuddled and read to and loved and played with and all those wonderful things. All I'm saying is that's harder if you're in dreadful poverty. And it relates to another point that I wanted to make. An interesting recent book, Scarcity, by a Harvard and Princeton economist and psychologist, ask the question, why is it that the poor seem to make self-defeating decisions? Why is it they don't take their medicines, they don't attend for screening? In India, they get a bit of money and instead of buying fertilizer that would improve the crop yield, they spend it on their daughter's wedding or whatever it is. The poor seem to be making these self-defeating choices, and that's why they're poor. And they say that's got the causal direction absolutely upside down. It's being in poverty that reduces your executive function of the brain and makes it harder to make these longer-term decisions. If you're worried, and we all know this, I mean, Harry said that everybody in this room would have some experience of poverty in their family. If your family's worried about feeding the children, they're going to be less concerned with making the long-term strategic decision. It's how do I get through the day or the week, not what will the next 10 years look like. And a wrinkle, well, it's more than a wrinkle, a different approach to that is saying not that they're wrong in scarcity, that circumstances of poverty reduce your executive function, but that begins in early childhood. It relates to what Sir Harry said about early deprivation sculpting the brain. That executive function and empathy, the different parts of the prefrontal cortex, the temporal lobe, the other parts of the brain that are affected by poverty, can influence children's executive function, influence their ability to make strategic decisions as they get older. So by no means am I saying this is just about poverty and what the Chancellor does. It's about the quality of input that children receive. But that quality of input is affected by the circumstances in which that's happening. Now people can rise above their poverty. As it was put to me in Tower Hamlets in East London, the Director of Education said, we tell ourselves every day that poverty is not destiny. And we think we can deliver good services despite poverty. And I said, show me. So they sent me the data. They've closed the gap in school performance between Tower Hamlets and the English average. They're putting it into practice by good services. The Director of Education can't reduce poverty, but she can motivate her staff to give good services, and they're doing it. So I'm sorry if I misled you. This when we're on the same page here.
And could I just, before I bring Sahar in, but if the Chancellor took a different decision earlier on, perhaps before the child was born, have you data that can point to, would it be cheaper to take that decision, or is it more expensive to do all the interventions that Sir Harry outlined, which were substantial earlier on?
I very rarely quote Chicago economists. I develop a tic when I start to think about Chicago economists. But Jim Heckman, Nobel Prize-winning Chicago economist, says that early childhood is a rare example of public policy where equity and efficiency come together. And I don't believe their models unless I agree with the conclusion. And his conclusion, very clear, he's got a graph, that the earlier in life you spend that dollar, the greater the economic benefit. The earlier in life, I don't know if he's taken it back to pre-birth, but you could, even to preconception, but certainly in utero, the earlier in life you spend that dollar, the greater the economic benefit. Now, again, I agree with Sir Harry, we're not in this for economic benefit, we're in this to improve health and well-being of our populations, but it turns out there's good economic benefit as well.
Can I just interrupt you again? But unfortunately, the life of politics is full of politicians who make decisions based on cost rather than improving people's health. That's for sure. And that's what's happening right at this very time. So, Harry, I'm sorry.
The very children who experience chaotic early lives will turn out to be the adults who have chronic disease, who have a long spell of unhealthy life in later life. You know, it's a no-brainer. Many years ago, I wrote a paper on programme budgeting and marginal analysis in which we changed a service in Glasgow We saved, by working with the clinicians, we produced a better service with additional consultants and physiotherapists and so on, and saved about £1 million in the process. By seeing that whole programme as a single budgetary entity, we were able to move money around and save money at the same time. It's high time we began to see the life course in those terms. By demonstrating that the costs of chronic disease, the costs of keeping people in prison, the costs of educational failure are huge, that allows you to identify the sum of money that theoretically you can move into early years. You can then identify what at the margins is movable and begin to make that turn around. Now, finance directors hate that because it stops them doing what finance directors do, which is, you know, move money from one box to another and keep everyone happy. It imposes a discipline on them, yes, that really stops them being able to wire money in all sorts of directions. But it's the way in which we will transform the economics of this, and it can be done. And we've started looking at exactly how we can do that. And first thing I did in my new job, because I understand that is what... that's what will allow politicians to say, yes, we can do this. But as I keep saying, all politicians want to do the right thing. They just differ slightly in the way in which they want to do it. But I have no doubt you guys want to do the right thing. And I think our job is to try and show you how you can do that in ways that meet political expediency.
Okay, thanks very much.
Richard Simpson.
Scotland has a long history of trying to improve things for people. I mean, the lad of Pairts is an expression which we recognise. When I was at university, we had Meal Monday, which allowed poorer people to go back and get their oatmeal supplies for the next few months. So we have a long history at that level, and we've increased higher and further education to 50%. It was only 10% when I was at university. The next stage was that Labour, when it came in, introduced nursery education. Sure Start, which is, there's some evidence, has been helpful. Community schools, again, coming down to the next level. But the group that really, I think, we haven't explored adequately is actually the minus one to plus 6 months. I mean, I'm old enough to remember Balby, you know, now, what, 60, 70, 60 years on? Lorenz's original Gosling studies are 80 years on. The attachment, if you don't have initial attachment, no matter what you do in terms of free nursery education, in terms of picking up people with problems, speech problems at school, studying people in schools and seeing where you can improve things, you've had it already, surely. So, you know, what should we be doing, you know, apart from the Family Nurse Partnership, which is great, but it's only in Edinburgh, where there's substantial deprivation, massive problems of attachment. It's only 120 families. What are we doing about that group? And can we do it without actually addressing that attachment group?
I mean, you're absolutely right, Richard. This has been my thing. And the whole business about the plasticity of the brain, we attribute to different patterns of attachment in very early life. Different centres of the brain grow more rapidly depending on the attachment experience. The early years collaborative has set out, you know, minus 9 months to, at the moment, five, although it's being extended to eight. The minus 9 months is about beginning to get young women who have had no experience of attachment themselves to understand what that means and to begin to support them. And FNP, yeah, East of Scotland has lots of it. I mean, for those of you that don't understand what it is, every teenage girl who becomes pregnant is offered a family nurse, regardless of whether or not they live in Barnton or Western Hales. The fact is that most teenage pregnancies occur in deprived areas, so it tends to be like that, but there's no discrimination. And that nurse stays with that girl during pregnancy and during the first couple of years of the child's life. And when I went to see this in action, and there was a 16-year-old girl there, the attachment behaviour that she showed with her baby was utterly impressive. The father came in, he too had learned to attach. And then she got in a taxi and went back to school because she had planned a career. She was sitting five hires. She knew what she wanted to do. And I said to the nurse, what would she be doing if you weren't here? And she said, well, typically she'd be out with her friends down the shopping centre buying a bottle of vodka. And it's utterly transformative of these children's, the parents, the children who are parents and their children's lives. And we need to do far more of that. And it is about building empathy. There are Glasgow is using triple P, which is a different style of things, but, you know, it seems to be as evidence-based. And the point is that we want local authorities to and community planning partnerships to develop their own style of enhancing attachment behaviour. There's been too much directiveness, and this business of co-producing it, I think, is really important. The key thing is we want them to collect the data so that they will see what's working and what isn't working and stop doing what isn't working. But, yeah, attachment, I couldn't agree with you more. It's absolutely central foundation to future success, and it builds the kind of biology that we've been talking about that will lead to reduced risk of ill health later in life, reduced risk of mental ill health in early adulthood. So yeah, you're right, and we want to do more of it, and we will continue to do more of it. But in order to afford expansion of this, we're going to have to find ways of looking at the programme budget in its entirety.
Just the other thing I would add, the way you began, you know, we've been concerned about this for a very long time. Things have got better, no question. You know that. You know that from your own experience, apart from the data. Things have got dramatically better. Think what it was to be born in Scotland 100 years ago, 50 years ago, 30 years ago. Things have got dramatically better. Babies don't die the way they used to. I mean, again, I know the English data better than I know the Scottish data, but the Roundtree study in York in 1900, the best off in York, the best off group, the servant keeping class in York, had an infant mortality of 90 per 1,000 live births. The worst off now in England is about 6. I mean, you can find single mothers unemployed or something, maybe get it up to 9. So the best off 100 years ago, 90 per 1,000 live births. The worst off now is perhaps 9. So it's an order of magnitude different. And quality of early child development is presumably, although we don't have the good figures over time, has presumably improved too. The major issue that confronts us are the inequalities, the fact that not everybody's benefiting to the same extent, and that's the major challenge. So some of what we've understood over these years has been put into practice, and things have got dramatically better. But we're now challenged by the inequalities. And the fact, particularly in Glasgow, as I've been quoting all around the world, the worst off don't look very respectable in terms of life expectancy in any country in the world, the worst off in Glasgow. I mean, it's really shocking. So it's the inequalities. This is not really relevant to the committee, but Bulby's son is my neighbour. And I was going for a walk and I bumped into him and I said something about attachment. I had to explain to my wife where I'd been for the last hour because he'd been giving me a lecture about attachment, you know, his father's theories. But
and the other group within that, if I may, supplementary, just is the, was mentioned earlier on, we've got 16,000 looked after children in Scotland. I myself was adopted, so I was extremely lucky. I had a rapid adoption after birth. So, you know, but I was appalled when I was working in adoption and fostering that the first case I had, they were looking at placing this baby in fostering care. And when I looked at the papers, it had already been placed 17 times in foster placement. So linking to my question on attachment, You know, how do we actually, you know, the sort of philosophy of my generation has been, you must always try and get the child back to its natural parents. But, you know, placing a child 17 times, what chance has that child got of getting any sort of reasonable attachment, any sort of reasonable brain development that will allow it to benefit from the free nursery education, good care, et cetera. So, you know, what do we do about that in a way that can...
Well, I think we'll have an opportunity later to discuss with colleagues who have a specific interest in this area exactly how we do it. One of the interesting things that's taking place in Glasgow is the study of the New Orleans approach to adoption and fostering, and I wouldn't presume to say anything about it other than to say that it seems quite a strongly evidence-based pattern of deciding if a child should go back to its natural parents or should be looked after in an adoptive home. But you're absolutely right, bouncing a child round. I mean, the macaque monkeys, one of the key determinants of stress and poor outcome in these macaque monkeys is inconsistency in parenting, changing patterns of rearing from one day to the next. Just consistency is really important in all of this, and we need to work to do that. And it comes back to this point of our attitudes to children. You know, do we care enough about them? You know, if a child falls and hurts itself in the playground, not to be able to give it a hug and comfort it seems to me to be inhuman, to be honest. And I said this to the Association of Directors of Social Work a few years ago, and there were gasps of horror in the room. This man's a raving lunatic. He wants to hug children. Well, we now know that there are epigenetic effects of happiness in children that switch off and switch on certain genes. That's not the reason we should do it. We should do it because it's our natural instinct to nurture people in difficulty and to nurture weaker people, weaker than ourselves. And all of us in society benefit from demonstrating that. We are not Anglo-Saxon, I don't think. The more time I spend in the Nordic countries, the more I think we have much more in common with them. You know, their attitudes to children and to each other, that's actually where I would want to be honest.
Thank you.
Jackson Carlow.
So Harry, I certainly found your opening presentations and your contributions enormously lucid and interesting. I've noted it. I've agreed with a lot of it, surprisingly, sometimes to myself. I've disagreed with some. I shall certainly, however, having listened, reflect, I think, on a lot. And I think the themes that have been explored this morning are almost so broad and so huge that it's impossible to condense anything now into a meaningful question. I've had a long-term attachment to the idea of universal health visiting. I've noticed what you've said about proportionate universalism and the focus that there might be where that's most needed. I wonder, in two or three small questions that I might draw out, I agree, I think, with what Sir Harry was saying about the silos of the financing of this and the inability of some to see where future savings might be assumed now and redirected, and the individuality that's needed. And I noted what you said, Sir Michael, about there being a difference in outcomes at certain levels of inequality in different places. I wonder if you think how you reconcile that need to be individual in the approach that we have within different authorities and health boards, and the difference in the outcomes that we sometimes see, and whether we are, for want of a better word, ruthless enough about trying to ensure that we direct what works rather than always allowing what doesn't to become embedded and entrenched. And secondly, you were asked if you were Chancellor and you said you wouldn't. And can I say that at times we've perhaps skirted a utopian ceiling in some of the conversation we've had. But given that you have been in Scandinavian countries where there is this greater focus on early years, what would you say to us if, as politicians, having to work within an envelope ultimately, that you have maybe learned from their health services that they don't spend so much time doing that we spend perhaps too much time doing that could be a source of redirection?
Well, thank you for those. Interesting. Can I start with Scandinavia first, the Nordic countries? human nature is alive and living in the Nordic countries. They're not different from us. They're not some different species. They have... I've been to the Swedish Parliament recognisably. I could pick out who's on the left and who's on the right, and it's all very recognisable. They have the same sort of debates we do. Interesting. What's really inspired me more recently is where the national government has been reluctant to act, local government has acted, has taken it on. So, as one Swede said to me, you've become a brand name in Sweden now. There are three reports. I was just earlier in the year in Malmö, last year in Malmö, when the Swedish city of Malmö produced a report on a socially sustainable Malmö. So they took my WHO, Commission on Social Determinants of Health report, and said, how could we apply this in one city? And I said, Sweden, you don't need this. And they took me to areas of Malmö where there's greater than 60% male unemployment in Malmö. So they do need it. They have big inequalities right in the city. And what they did was get the health service, to come back to your question, involved, but they got the mayor involved. In fact, the mayor commissioned the review, the commission. So they got local politicians, they got education, they got health services, they all the main sectors, and they owned it. And they did something similar in Östergötland, which is Linköping, Norrköping, so just south of Stockholm. And I was there last week for a progress report on their big review. They got the politicians involved from the beginning as members of the review. And they were concerned that they might be too pragmatic, the politicians. They might say, now, come on, guys, let's get feasible. What you're saying, we're practical people. They said that wasn't the case. Everybody got engaged to the same extent. And the advantage of having the politicians involved with the third sector, with the civil society people and the academics and local government, was that there's more chance of what they come up with being implemented because the politicians own it. And I had Social Democrats come up to me and say, you know, we're hoping we're going to... But had the right of centre people come up as well. And I was trying to get out of their political debate. I'm only pleased if they can have the centre-right and the centre-left engaged at the same time. And that seemed to me a very good message. Now, I say there's normal life. They don't like each other much. But so it's human nature in Sweden as well. But they've got the centre-right and the centre-left both engaged in this. And I think that's a very important message because they're saying, starting right from birth through the life course, that these inequalities have to be addressed. And they have to be addressed not just through the healthcare system. And I think that's a very important message. And if the national government isn't doing it, then local and regional government can do it. I think it's important that national government do it too. But you know, I don't want to get into Scottish politics. But I think having it at the city level, having it at the Scottish level, and of course having it at the UK level are all important. But we know in England, 3/4 of local authorities have Marmot implementation plans. So whatever is or isn't happening at the national level, we've got local government. I've talked to Local Government Association, which until very recently was always led by a Conservative, and they're my great allies in England, the Local Government Association. And I think that's a very important message.
I think this localism approach is very important, and taking Bob Doris's comment earlier on about community empowerment, this is absolutely central to this. I am not going to go into detail, but working with local authorities across Scotland, I can see very great difficulties and differences in capacity and willingness to act. you do come across the not invented here syndrome. You know, if they're doing it over there, we couldn't. We'll have to do something different, and so on. And you know, that's fine. The critical thing is count what you're doing, and if it works, do more of it. And if it doesn't work, stop doing it, and be man enough to admit that you've done something wrong. And that's at the heart of the Early Years Collaborative. Every 5 months or so, 800 people from across all 32 community planning partnerships get together to look at what they've done and to share the results. And we're beginning to see key changes emerge that we need to build upon. But, you know, all of these things are necessary but not sufficient. We need to join it all up. And I think it's perfectly possible for really good local authorities and, you know, the ones that you and I are both familiar with are really, really good at this kind of thing. It's perfectly possible for really good local authorities to move a long way down this direction. But we also need the overarching economic structures that allow us to tackle the lives of people who really, really struggle. And, you know, I would invite, I'm sure Martin Johnson wouldn't mind me saying this, but to sit with the Poverty Truth Commission and hear the stories of middle class, you know, people just like us who can't afford to eat for 2 or 3 days a week. Literally, they eat nothing for 2 or 3 days a week because they can't afford it. It's very chastening. It makes you realise that we need that overarching approach from government that ensures that there is equitable distribution of goods and power and so on in society, but also the localism that allows us to support people in difficulty who just don't know how to look after their children. We need to do all of those things, and at the heart of it, I would say, is the culture. We need to start looking out for each other. I mean, I'd just like to quote the Violence Reduction Unit invited a clergyman from South Los Angeles over to Glasgow a few months ago who had transformed the gang culture in South Los Angeles and basically found jobs for them. He created social enterprises, Homeboy Industries. And he said in the course of the day, made a statement that really has stuck with me, that what we need in society is a compassion that stands in awe at the burdens the poor have to carry, rather than stands in judgment at the way they carry them. And I think if that's our starting point, wow, how would we be in similar circumstances if we had to deal with the lives that these people live? And what kind of help and support would we need? That, I think, is a good starting point for transformation of our society.
Thank you. Good morning. I have to say that I found this absolutely fascinating. The 6 months I've been on the Health Committee, I think it's grabbed me really from the word go, from your first words. I'm had me thinking all through this about the proportionate universalism and how, as soon as you set levels, say in taxation and stuff like that, the people just above that level tend to get hit harder. And it doesn't, the idea of this proportionate aspect really sort of hits through and how we can bring this into perhaps a wider part of society. It's certainly got me thinking. I'll be going away with these things in mind, but could I perhaps, since we're running a little shy in time, to go back to what was said about the stuff, Sir Harry, particularly about the empathy, that one of the things we always shout about, of course, is the fact we're Scots. You know, we're probably one of the most social-minded groups in the world and all this sort of thing. And some of the things, of course, you came out with earlier, I found quite fascinating, the difference between Manchester, Liverpool, Glasgow, for instance. And I was wondering, in terms of, a lot of this appears to come down to attitude of what we think we are at this time, and heading backward to the thing about not being able to hug a child, or if you are a coach in sports, not being able to touch a child, to show them where to put their arm in badminton or something like that. And this fear that appears to have been brought through, and we've heard about the child protection issues. Are we getting to the point, if we're going too far with this, and we have to rethink our attitudes on tactile methods of communication, such as hugs and whatever, within our entire society, not necessarily the young child crying, but this whole thing where it's based on fear, you cannot do this. Is this the sort of thing that's going to drag the idea of the things that you've been talking about down?
Yeah, I mean, in the talks I give, one of the points I make is this notion, this thing about the molecular biology of a hug, and when I talk about that, quite often there's a wee queue of people wanting to give me a hug afterwards. And sometimes that's okay, but sometimes I'm just not so sure. But so it's a kind of, yeah, it's a difficult question, and the child protection issue is a really, really serious one. I mean, we can't duck it. It's out there, and we've reacted to it, and we've reacted to it in a way that I think dehumanises us. I mean, it's a small issue, but it's a very, very serious issue, and damaging a child in any way is, you know, is, to my mind, is a really, really serious crime against humanity. But we're damaging children by not showing them that kind of empathy as well, and we need to rediscover a balance. We need to, you know, we need to realise that, and I'm very conscious about this because my daughter's just had her first grandchild, so I'm absolutely obsessed with watching how she interacts with her and how the attachment process is going on. We need to realise that that is a very important part of human development, and it's not something that is exclusively the province of the parents. It's the province of other people who show affection for the child. And we need to rediscover that balance. I would leave it to experts in child protection to comment as to where that balance lies, but I would just want to raise the flag that I think the balance is way too far to one side. Mm-hmm. And when a child is crying and looking for comfort, it's our responsibility to show them that kind of comfort. And, you know, I just think that the rules and regulations get in the way of us acting like human beings. Mm-hmm.
I suppose my next question would have been, how do you do this?
Well, I think we need to talk to child protection experts about this and not accept the blanket ban on this. There has to be a better way of doing that.
One final question for me, in terms of the message that I can take away today, is that the examples of Tower Hamlets and Birmingham is that good services can close the gap, can make a difference. Let me finish that you can respond to both of them, Sir Harry. The other message that we've got continually as well, health interventions are important. It can't deal with this on its own, and that reflects, I think, all of the evidence that we've had through this whole scoping exercise. But it is the only portfolio that's got a clear priority for health inequalities and sets out a whole list of targets. Are they still relevant? If they are relevant, should similar targets and that principle of equity be reflected in the other portfolios? Does that help?
Very important question, and the thing that's given me sleepless nights more than anything else is this question. From the time that I started chairing the WHO Commission on Social Determinants of Health, the question ministers of education asked is, why should I care about health? That's not my job. That's your job, Minister of Health, not my job. And the Minister of Finance says, why should I care about health? That's your job, Minister of Health, not my job. And the Minister of Health says, if we take seriously what you're saying about social determinants of health, I'll be out of a job. So I've had ministers of education and environment and finance say health's not my job, and the Minister of Health saying, I don't want to listen to what you're saying because I'll be out of a job if those guys in education, environment and finance take health seriously. So I've been struggling with this for the last decade. And what I can say is I can show you good examples where we've managed to break down those barriers, where we've actually managed to get ministers of education realize that what they do in their day job has a positive impact on health. I had, coming back to the Nordic countries, I had a minister of foreign affairs in Norway say, I am a health minister, because what we do, what I do in my day job impacts on health. In fact, I had a phone call from an official in the Ministry of Health in Norway saying, you know, you've been going around the world quoting our foreign minister saying, I am a health minister. He now is our health minister. and he wants to meet you. But he came to that portfolio with a rich understanding that he had to work with his colleagues. And when I went to Norway to meet the Minister of Health, we had a seminar at a table like this with 13 different government departments. They even had the Ministry of Defence discussing health. They had 13 different government departments, and when the ministers left, the senior officials stayed in the room to keep discussing their cross-government strategy. I think that health inequalities should be a corporate issue for the whole of government, that these should be not a health goal for the Ministry of Education, a health inequalities goal for government. It should be for the whole of government. And I went to a similar meeting in Peru recently, in Lima, where the Prime Minister chaired a meeting and they had 11 other ministers round the table. This was a corporate issue for the whole of government. So the whole of government says we've got under 5 mortality figures that shame us. This is a reflection not on the Minister of Health, it's a reflection on the government. We've got early child development figures, inequalities, that shame us. We've got PISA scores that shame us. This is for the whole of government because these are going to impact on health. So that's my way of saying we've got to get health and health equity into the thinking of the whole of government so that it's in whatever government department does.
My response to that is that when you use the word health, lots of people think about illness. You know, the health service treats illness and it prevents illness. And what I've been talking about is well-being, inequalities in well-being, because that includes inequalities in educational attainment, inequalities in offending behaviour, inequalities in employment, success and so on. And I think inequalities in well-being are clearly a matter for the whole of government, for the whole of society. So I would encourage you to think about positive health as opposed to disease. Inequalities in disease incidence, yeah, really important, but inequalities in the whole panoply of outcomes, I think, are very important. And I think that we're ahead of the game in Scotland. Historically, I mean, Scotland had 2 medical officers of health before England had 1. You know, we've had a long history in Scotland of concern for public health. The first study I can find anywhere in the world of inequalities in health was carried out by the city treasurer of Glasgow in the mid-19th century. When he looked at infant mortality and affluent and measured affluence and deprivation. We've got this very long history of concern. We've had a huge tradition of academic research into inequalities in health, and you'll hear about more of that later on. We know more about it than most places in the world. So we've got a good start in Scotland, and we need to push on and just fix it. I have, you know... The chief medical officer in England is the chief medical officer of the UK government, and the UK government is the member of World Health Organization and so on. So when the World Health Organization wants a chief medical officer, they're supposed to go to the chief medical officer in Westminster. But in fact, a lot of the times they come to me because they see Scotland as being a leading place for thinking about this. Countries in the Balkan region and in Scandinavia and so on really want to know what we're doing. We need to build on this, and we need to move forward, and we have huge opportunity to do so. And the fact that, you know, this committee and the audit committee and so on have taken such an interest in this, I think is a terrifically positive sign.
But you're in a privileged position that you've worked with all shades of government over the devolution process.
Yep, and every politician, every health minister I've worked with wanted to do the right thing.
Yes, absolutely. Has the description of other governments across the world taken that wider corporate responsibility? Did you witness that over the period of devolution? It's not evident, is
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it's very patchy. I mean, most places that invite you to come and talk about this kind of thing are already there, they're already interested, they've made the decision. But I've been, and I won't name names, but I've been to some places recently, countries significantly affected by austerity, and you talk like this and they just look at you as if you're daft. You know, how could... I mean, I went to speak to a group of doctors in one country recently, and they really thought I was bonkers talking about wellness and well-being rather than talking about treatment of disease. We're ahead of the game, and the fact that our size makes it accessible. I mean, we can get 800 people into a room, and that reaches into every community planning partnership is a really significant advantage.
We had evidence on the community planning partnership last week, and some gaps there. We're running out of time, but half local authorities haven't embarked on that journey.
There's a variation.
There are issues here that we're not applying. We'll have an opportunity in the next session to maybe discuss some of that. But what I'm trying to focus that back to is Scottish governments, not just the present government, but Scottish governments over that period of devolution, given all of the knowledge, the world-leading knowledge, the studies that have been carried out, you as a personality and advocate for all of this, what more do we need to do to ensure that at a Scottish government level that there's that corporate responsibility for health and well-being as it impacts? Because, you know, in children itself, there are a number of cabinet secretaries and ministers who represent not one single person, but four or five who have all shared responsibility for this. And at times, over that period of time, and being involved in some of these issues and raising some of these issues, children continually fall through the gaps because there doesn't seem to be that corporate responsibility, that one line, the equity as described by Sir Michael this morning is not embedded into every policy and every decision of government.
My experience as chief medical officer was that ministers were very accessible. Civil servants across government saw it as their shared responsibility to come together. Silos were really not in evidence within the civil service. Everyone continues to come together, and I'm still involved in some of the work around inequalities in young people for the Scottish Government. What I think could improve is coming together with local authorities and voluntary agencies by working seamlessly, not just across the way, but at different levels. I think that's where the gaps are, because some local authorities, as I've already mentioned, it's the not invented here syndrome. Some local authorities are less willing to take on new ideas than others. The voluntary sector is doing fantastic work. Can we spread that? Can we join it all up? Can we learn from the successes? Lots of small projects going on that are doing good things. If we can measure what they're doing, if we can count what they're doing and spread it, then we will begin to plug the gaps, we'll seal the gaps. Yeah. It's, government can't do this on its own. It can create a facilitation, but the other levels of action in society need to be involved. And
it's just, sorry to press you, but that, that seamless nature that we require from local government, is that evident at a Scottish government level? When one portfolio will make a decision that impacts negatively on the outcomes for certain groups and children on the other.
My experience was that government has tried to make sure that there are no unintended adverse consequences of this kind of thing. And it just seems to me that if there are some of these adverse consequences emerging, then a better dialogue has to be important.
I'm not just talking about the present government, I'm talking about governments over the period of devolution.
The striking thing in my experience with ministers of different governments over the years since 1997 has been the great willingness to do what they need to do to fix the problem. And initially it was, tell us what to do. And since there's no one thing, it's about thinking much more about complex systems and how the interactions within complex systems can make things happen. And that's much more difficult. But it's much more dynamic change that needs to happen across the whole of society. And the collaborative approach, it may, that's evolving. But we're the first country in the world to try and make that level of change with that kind of method. And to my mind, we will see very soon some positive impacts.
Thank you very much for your precious time you've given us this morning and all of the evidence. And it will certainly make our discussions as a committee much more interesting. Thank you very much indeed for your presence here this morning. Thank you. Yeah, I'm going to suspend at this point until we set up for the next session. We will now reconvene in a round table panel in this session on our early years inquiry. And in the interest of time, I think people can introduce themselves maybe when they come in to speak, rather than just going through taking more precious time. I understand it's, my apologies, it's run on a wee bit, and there are people already under pressure, both committee members and panel members. So at this point, I'll go very quickly then to Aileen McLeod, a committee member who will ask her first question and kick us off. Thanks.
Convener, and obviously we heard earlier this morning from Sir Harry Burns and Professor Michael Marmot, and certainly I agree with a lot of the points that they raised. And in fact, Mr. Harry Burns mentioned that, you know, that Scotland, you know, is ahead of the game in what we're trying to do in terms of addressing inequalities in health. And I suppose for me, the concern I have around that is the extent to which, you know, our progress is being, you know, affected by, you know, the austerity and welfare reform. And one of the comments I was struck by this morning from Professor Marmot was, you know, around about the political choices that are made by the Chancellor affecting the quality of our early childhood development. Now, we know that, for example, the Scottish Government has estimated that welfare benefits will be cut by £6 billion by 2015-16, with over £1 billion of cuts relating directly to childcare, to children, in Scotland. And a number of these have had a direct impact on young families, such as the removal of the baby element of child tax credits, the abolition of the health and pregnancy grant, the abolition of the Child Trust Fund, and cuts to the Sure Start maternity grants. And obviously we have a rising number of the working poor. So what I'd like to ask around table this morning is, how do you think all of this affects the life chances of our children, and in the longer term, their health? And how do you think that we could, for example, better align our welfare system with our early years priorities, and, you know, so that we can actually improve in the longer term our inequalities, in not just health, but also in terms of our wellbeing as well?
Other committee members at this point, the panellists are, you know, we'll shorter questions and we'll give the time, all the time we have to our panellists. Professor Wilson, did you want to come in at that point?
And I must apologise for having to leave at 12. I'm from the University of Aberdeen, and I've been involved in a programme of work looking at assessing the social and emotional and language development of children at various ages in Glasgow, and that work's continuing. And I'd really like to make a plug, if you like, for acknowledging the importance of early childhood behaviour and social and emotional development. And in particular, I'd like to make a case for measuring social and emotional development in children, because actually that's the only way that we're going to be able to assess the impact of our services in the early years. It's an important issue. We know there are, you will have heard earlier, and there's a lot of other evidence supporting the importance of early language development, early social development, early development of behavioural regulation, and so on, and long-term health. For example, the 1958 birth cohort, children who were rated by their teachers as being in the top quarter for good behaviour, compared with children who were rated by their teachers, a very simple old-fashioned scale, who were rated to have bad behaviour. The children with good behaviour in the best quarter were half as likely to be dead at age 46 as the children who were rated to have bad behaviour at age 7. There are lots and lots and lots of other studies, longitudinal studies, which demonstrate the relationship between early behavioural, emotional, social regulation and language development and later health. You'll have seen in the written evidence to the committee that there are differences between different economic areas of Glasgow. We used a tool called the Strength and Difficulties Questionnaire, which measures emotional problems, conduct problems, hyperactivity and attention problems, and peer relationship problems. Very simple questionnaire, takes 5 minutes to complete. We found that the more deprived areas had on average a score which was half as high again as the more affluent areas. And you'll have seen, if you looked at my evidence, there is a map that we produced. These were questionnaires completed by nursery staff for every child in Glasgow. There are about 10,000 children represented in that map in the preschool year. And you'll see that the scores in Springburn were twice as high as the scores in Hillhead. Now, that's not the whole story. There is clearly strong social patterning of scores in the Strength and Difficulties questionnaire. But it's not just as simple as finance. For example, Govan, which is economically as badly off as many areas in the east end of Glasgow, is doing much better than we might expect. And that may be that there are better services, a better sense of community cohesion, maybe you're more likely to have your granny living around the corner. So there are factors which are beyond just financial factors. And we've started to unpick some of that. And we found, for example, that the strongest predictor of conduct problems in an area-based analysis in boys is the crime level. Crime level in local areas seems to be have a very high relationship, very strong relationship with conduct problems. It doesn't have the same relationship in girls, interestingly enough. So by analysing data from lots of children geographically, we can start to think about what the impact of interventions might be. The other advantage of measuring social, emotional, language development is that you can start to look at trajectories. If you can collect the data more than once for the same child, then you can start to look at what are the factors that indicate whether they're getting better or getting worse. And we've recently done some analyses for children in primary school, and we've shown that the big social differentials that exist in the preschool year get much bigger by primary three. So children who are in the affluent areas, who probably start school with advantage, get better, and children who are in the more deprived areas, who probably have less advantage, get worse. So I almost finished the point of trying to collect data. I'd like to just make a plea not to forget the importance of general practice in managing early problems in child health. Like health visitors, they're really the only professionals that are in contact with all children. And they are potentially a very useful resource for identifying vulnerability in early childhood.
Yeah, thanks. Anyone else wish to respond? Dr. Hill.
Dr. Hill from the University of Edinburgh. To respond to the original question, I think I'd reiterate the point that was made by Sir Michael Marmot about the need for a dual approach to addressing inequalities in the early years. So, of course, cuts to benefits is going to be problematic in terms of increasing the underlying social gradient. I do think, however, there are policies that the Scottish Government can pursue to try and ameliorate decisions that are made in Westminster, and that includes measures such as the Scottish Government's commitment to try and implement a living wage, for example, including in its capacity as an employer. And I also think that the second of Sir Michael's strategy is an important one, and obviously that's one where there is much more capacity for the Scottish Government to take a lead. And in particular, I would emphasise the role of early childhood education as acting as an ameliorating influence for children who come from disadvantaged backgrounds. So I think that it's important to think of the opportunities that are available for trying to improve the early childhood experience of children growing up in Scotland, and that includes not only the government has taken steps to improve access to early child care, and I think that that's a really positive move and one that I suspect will be beneficial in economic terms, but I think if we want that to also lead to improvements in terms of both educational and health outcomes, we need stronger investment in the educational aspect of early childhood care. So I think not just childcare, but early childhood education, qualified, well-supported preschool education, I think, offers a really huge opportunity to try and ameliorate some of the more negative impacts of cuts in benefits.
Alan Sinclair.
Sinclair, I'm here, Centre of Confidence and Wellbeing, but for many years I'd set up a thing called the WISE Group in Heatwise Glasgow, which was dealing with very long-term unemployed. And a lot of that experience I can play into what you're, the question you're asking. And if I can just say this, that what we discovered is that we took a couple of thousand long-term unemployed through each year and we got 50-60% into jobs. But there was a very significant slice of usually young men, but also young women, who we could not help. And the more we analysed and dug into that, they were very frequently coming to us and they had virtually no social skills whatsoever. You know, homemade tattoos, sports clothes, almost could hardly talk to you and hold your eye. And yet we were to get them jobs. And there was no chance of them getting a job, if truth be told. Actually, what we then also discovered, that most of this group were parents already two or three times over. So there was a major intergenerational issue going on. And the tool that we were meant to change that with was, on the one hand, welfare benefit, and then the other one, getting them a job. And actually, it was a different category we had to look at, because we could not retrofit the soft skills that they needed. And in a sense, sorry, my issue there would then take us in to what we are trying to do on welfare policy, what are we trying to do on health policy to actually get those almost empathetic in language and behavioural skills, which happens before you get to school rather than when you get to 21 years of age.
Anyone else? Brenda Dunn.
Brenda Dunn, University of Dundee. I just wanted to go back to the point that Sarah made about educating and having care and well-being and education for young children. I think it's also important, if we're going to do that, that we really consider how we educate the practitioners that are looking after these children. It isn't just a case of giving children extra hours in a nursery situation or an out-of-school care or a playgroup. It's really considering who's going to look after these children, and we want them to be people who are really well qualified. And because what concerns me is quite often it's the most inexperienced and the youngest practitioners who do not have the qualifications that are looking after babies in the baby room. So we really do need to consider things like Making a Difference, Education Scotland's report on if people are educated practitioners or lead practitioners with perhaps a BA in childhood practice or teachers with an early years qualification, they can make a difference. And the HMI reports have shown that in a very large way.
Thanks for that. On that theme, can I engage some people on that theme? Because, you know, in the written evidence, you know, this come up in different ways, and there's a presumption, obviously, in those very, very early years, not to 6 months or whatever, then GPs, nurses would be involved. But none of the written evidence does it say, you know, the how important that those nursery workers, care workers, who spend an awful amount of time with children and young people, and you're raising the issue. So could we have some discussion maybe about the workforce capacity and the quality, what's actually there on the ground and what's important? Jonathan Shea, Dr. Jonathan.
Thank you. I'll leave it to others who are more expert about workforce issues than I am.
I was just going to develop that from, if you've not got a workforce issue, can I get?
But the point I do have to make, right, involves the workforce, but not just. And that is that if there's one of the very basic messages that I hope the committee will pick up and act on is the quality of relationships, that so much of reducing inequalities whether it's health inequalities or others, is down to the nature of and quality of the relationship. First and foremost, the relationship between a baby and the parent or carer, but also the relationship between the parents, the relationship between the parents and people like GPs and health visitors and nursery staff, because it isn't enough to just make this a numbers game. The research is absolutely clear that increasing the number of workers only has meaning if what's happened is that there's been the development of healthy, trusting, two-way relationships of respect and care all the way across the spectrum. So to use health visitors as an example, increasing the numbers and reducing caseloads, absolutely. But that's only going to work if health visitors are able to develop the kind of nurturing two-way relationships with parents. More health visitors going around and saying, this is what you need to do, or, oh my gosh, what a terrible job you're doing. Somehow that isn't very effective. And so it is those relationships across the board that are absolutely crucial, and it's not something that we tend to focus on.
Again, the written evidence shows us that there's less health visitors. Yes, Professor Wolves.
Just to make a point, in the written evidence I raised the issue that general practitioners are now doing much less preventive child health work than they used to, and that's really largely a result of the 2004 contract. So there's no incentive for GPs to get involved in preventive child health work and child health surveillance. In addition to that, there have been a number of well-intentioned, but ultimately, I think, ineffective policy decisions around health visiting. Health visitors have ceased to be the experts in normal child development. Child development fell out of the syllabus about 10 years ago in health visiting. It's an ageing workforce. There have been a whole series of developments which have demoralised the workforce, and there is a big, big issue there because they are the major support to parents in the pre-nursery years. In addition, there have been a very strong managerial push towards so-called skill mix in health visiting teams, which means that health visitors themselves, the professionals who are educated in this area, are not delivering most of the service. Most of the service has been delivered by much less well-trained colleagues. And there's been a mentality where continuity of care is not given the importance that it perhaps should have, so that people don't know who the health visitor is anymore. And this is a big, big issue, I think, for a lot of families. And I think it's something that should be fixed, if possible.
Hi, I'm Ben Farrugia from the University of Strathclyde Centre for Excellence for Looked After Children. I would echo Jonathan's words about both having the quality of relationships, but my day job is working with local authorities and in some cases NHS boards looking at some of the interventions they can provide to Looked After Children. And our experience at CELSIS is that there is a capacity gap, and a lot of the solutions that we look to problems are constricted by the envelope being so small. And when I think about care leavers in particular and the world that they're projected into and what we expect in terms of them holding on to relationships with workers, whether it's their social workers or three care workers or a foster carer or a resi worker, that is very difficult in the context that we currently have in Scotland. A foster carer is going to take on new children. It's maybe difficult to maintain that in some cases, and with a resi worker, as was said earlier on in the prior session, that can be actively frowned upon in some cases. But there is a capacity problem that we do see, whether it's in schools with support staff and guidance teachers for children who may need them in that context, whether it's health visitors and elsewhere. And I think that's something which I think it would be helpful for the committee to hold in mind when they're thinking about what are our solutions to the problem.
Thanks. Paul Bradshaw.
Paul Bradshaw, ScotCen Social Research, but also Project Director of the Growing Up in Scotland study. And I really wanted to come back to the point about preschool educators and practitioners working in preschool, and really just as a point of information for people on the panel and in the committee, that we've got a forthcoming piece of research using Growing Up in Scotland data, where we have information on children's social, emotional and behavioural outcomes and on their cognitive ability, and we've been following these children from birth. And children in our older group are now approaching 10 years old, but we also know which preschool centre they attended, and we've linked that information and extracted details about quality inspections from those preschools, and we're now exploring the relationship between aspects of quality that the children of the preschool centre that children attended and the relationship between changes in their behavioural and emotional outcomes and their cognitive ability. And we are finding some relationship in particular between specific aspects of quality of the environment attended, preschool environment attended by children, and some of these outcomes. I can't say any more at the moment. The report will be published next month. And it's not an unusual finding, because we do have other research, particularly in the UK, that has found a relationship between the preschool environment, particularly the quality of the preschool environment, and child outcomes. The point, I guess, is, in the sense of proportionate universalism, you know, upwards of 95% of children in Scotland eligible for their preschool place take it. They're there, they attend, and they mostly go for the time that they're allocated. So it is a real opportunity to make a difference on a very broad scale.
Thanks. Alison Leslie.
I work at the University of Dundee in the Fatalities Investigation and Review Studies team. I think that the issues that have been raised about workforce are crucial, whether we're talking about workforce with young children, as Brent did, whether we're talking about the workforce with looked after children, whether we're talking about teachers, because to pull in some of the thinking from the earlier session, you know, in the wake of Bob's work, there was this concern that if the attachment bond was broken, it could never be repaired. And what we've learned since is that even children who've had the most traumatic, challenging, dreadful experiences can recover and become productive, fulfilled members of society with fulfilled relationships, and can become productive and caring parents. And the thing that makes a difference is one person who nurtures them, who responds to them, who believes in them, who values them. And so often when you talk to people who've had that journey, it comes down to there was a teacher, there was a dinner lady. I can't tell you how many times over the years people have told me about dinner ladies or janitors or care assistants, people in the school that are sort of, as they're doing their sort of work of tidying up and that, are talking to a child and making a child feel important. And these are the people that we don't invest enough in, or we don't recognise. And I think one of the things we need to think about is in the areas of Scotland where there are the greatest clusters of children who suffer from that early emotional trauma that can affect their life chances, their health so significantly. We need to ensure that the people working in those areas, in the schools, in the early care centres, are the most qualified, are the most compassionate, the most nurturing, because that's where the difference is going to be made.
Anyone else on that theme? Brenda Dunn.
Sorry.
No, don't.
It's something I feel very passionate about. Many years ago, I was a primary teacher in Dundee in a very deprived area, and there was a thing called Educational Priority Areas, EPAs, and I worked in one of the schools, and there was never a longitudinal study or anything done. It was something that we worked in partnership with the parents. We had smaller classes. I had the same class right through primary 6 and 7, and the difference that I know that we made to those children, because you were working individually, you empowered them. I mean, it did come from a deficit model, which I don't really agree with, but you empowered the children. You gave them the goals, the targets. They then set up their own goals and targets. They came to visit me years later when they were in secondary school. It was the first class I had had from that school where they went on to further education. Some of them went on to higher education, and I was so proud of them. And we made a difference. And it wasn't just me as a teacher. There were other people in the school equally working with children and classes. Why do we just abandon things like that and not sort of do the research over the years to see, and it does take a long time to see, did it make a difference? Because there was things from that that really worked, and it's a bit like the high scope, you know, approach. There's things that we should be learning from the past that we can take forward and use and make a difference. And these children I was working with were primary 6 and 7. They went on to secondary school full of confidence with, I can do. But it was about giving them the power and motivating them so that they sort of ran with things.
Anyone want to pick that up about that continuity and the importance of longer-term relationships in education and all this? None of our panel members? I'm going to let Bob take us another direction.
No, we're still in this direction because it was only if none of our witnesses want to say anything. In terms of preschool provision, very passionate about primary 6 and 7s there. Now, preschool provision can be 2.5 hours or 3 hour blocks of early learning and childcare, 2 or 3 or 4 days a week, depending on how it's structured. Now, irrespective of how we get there, there's a growing consensus that it has to be a radical, significant advancement in early learning and childcare from the age of 1 onwards has been presupposed as being the best way to do it. Now, separate from the economic benefit of that and the gender equalities, which I don't want to diminish, but I wish to put to one side just for a moment, in terms of attachment and relationships, if you've got a young child at 1, 2 or 3 developing a relationship with someone in a childcare establishment, not for 2.5 hours, 2 or 3 times a day, but an individual right throughout the week, is that also going to have much more nurturing effect in their development? So not just the fact that you're interacting with other kids, but you're going to have an adult role model continuity right throughout, I suppose, the working week. Has any of that, is there research in terms of the piecemeal approach to childcare versus a consolidated early years childcare approach where you can actually form bonds at the age of 2 or 3 with the early learning professionals? Some more on that would be quite helpful.
See if we can.
If there's not, okay.
Brenda Dunn, want to come back again?
Yes, okay. I think there could be more research into that. I know that obviously I work now with childcare practitioners and lead practitioners, and there's a, you know, they're very, very aware of attachment theory. There are specific staff who are responsible for specific groups of children, but I think what concerns me is sometimes when a child moves from the baby room into the next room, is that that bond may be broken in that they're then having to, you know, relate to new people, other practitioners. So I think you've got a really good point there, and it's maybe something we should be considering throughout, because certainly when I talked about the primary 6 and 7 class that I had for 2 years, that was attachment, that was a bond that the children and I had. And I think for very young children, we should be perhaps thinking about, it's not just about moving them from one room to another, but perhaps thinking about the attachment. So I think you've made a really good point and something that's worth considering about, and something I'll take into the BA course at the university. So thanks.
and then Alan Sinclair and Jonathan Sher, do you want back in? No, I'm not. But you were looking in my direction, and I felt under pressure. But Professor Frank hasn't contributed, so I'll bring you in.
Thank you. My concern about what is best practice in what I think everyone this morning has agreed is the essential investment for Scotland, which is better, earlier, high quality preschool education combined with care. My concern is you won't know whether you're doing a good job because you're not measuring any outcomes at the present time. So Scotland has no standardized measure of child development collected by everybody in any way that can be analyzed. And yet the Early Years Collaborative asks every local authority to improve early childhood development but doesn't give any guidance on the yardstick. So I won't go through our briefing because in it we describe the pilot project we did in East Lothian, to just pilot one measure that a teacher can fill out in 20 to 30 minutes for each child in their P1 class after they get to know them around Christmas time. We happen to use an instrument that's used every 3 years in every P1 student in all of Australia and now most of Canada, where it originated 15 or 20 years ago, this questionnaire for the teachers. My concern is that in attempting to get people to just hear us present the results, By the way, I have no intellectual property rights in this. It's run by a non-profit. It's nothing to do with that. This isn't even my area of interest. I'm just doing it because I think it's what Scotland needs. We showed the instrument works beautifully. It's very cheap, 7p annualized per capita of taxpayers, if you like, in the local shire. But nobody wants to talk about it because of the gridlock between local authorities and the Scottish government around who would pay for anything new and how much direction can the Scottish government give to local authorities about anything. So I just want to ask the question to the members. Are we at the point where it's somehow improper to suggest that a standardized measuring stick should be used throughout Scotland for child development, at least at school entry, so we know how to allocate resources where the need is instead of just giving everybody a proportion of the budget for preschool that's equal to their population, proportionate to their population? That's how we're doing it now. There's no measure of need. I understand that comparisons are odious. I understand that it will reveal massive differences between communities. But right now, you're not managing by outcomes. I'll just leave you with one thought. A very famous person in health services and policy once said, what gets measured gets acted on. Right now, nothing's being measured. I don't mind which instrument is used, but I'm quite stunned by the inability to even have the conversation in the present climate of intergovernmental relations in Scotland.
Measuring need, meeting need, funding need. Anyone, any takers?
That was certainly one of the things that I had on my list of things to say today, and I agree with everything which Philip Wilson has said and both Professor John Frank. That I suppose for the committee, I mean, I suppose I wasn't aware if you were aware yourselves of some of the initiatives that the Scottish Government have been trying to pursue through the Joint Improvement Team and some of the relationships with local authorities around doing population-wide surveys. Of course, both in the context of some of the great work which is done through GUS as well and seeing how that can complement some of that. I suppose, one of my reflections is, having been close to some of the development of some of those projects, we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that there are people in our society who can be quite resistant to some of these things, and we should be aware that there is sometimes parental pushback on some of this, and I think that's probably a failure in how we communicate the benefits of this. And I think sometimes, because of that challenge, we've gone about it in a way which perhaps could be perceived to be a little bit mischievous and devious, and that's not the case, and that's not our intention, but I think we need to be clearer about our intentions and promote the benefits in terms of planning for outcomes. So.
Alan Sinclair, Jonathan Sher, Dr. Buston, and Dr. Sarah Hill. See if I can remember all of that now. Alan.
Thank you. I'm trying to remember the original question here, which was one about daycare. And I have to tell you, I'm getting increasingly concerned that we think daycare is the answer to early years, because I think it obfuscates the issues. Daycare normally starts at age 3. The big issues in a child's life are from conception, 2-3 years of age. And the more we talk about daycare, the more I think we get ourselves up into a cul-de-sac. Significantly more important is the issue that John Frank has raised, which gathers zero attention, which is we don't even know how we're doing in Scotland. We haven't got these things measured. And unless we do something like that, I fear that we will continue to have rather pious and woolly and well-intentioned discussions as a substitute for actually scientifically managed progress or the opposite of progress. And we don't know whether we're going that way or this way at the moment. But we have a lot of sound and fury.
Dr. Shea. Yes, I'm speaking today on behalf of Wave Trust, and in the written submission there is a document that I commend to you done before I arrived at Wave Trust, so there's no pride of authorship, called Conception to Age 2, the Age of Opportunity. And some of you have already seen and had a chance to look at that, but it contains a great deal of the latest evidence from around the world on what works and what doesn't work, whether it's about improving the workforce or enhancing attachment. the crucial part of it is to follow up on Alan's point. It is about the age of opportunity being conception to age two. And yet the conversation here continues to be a conversation about early years starting at preschool. And I think that the focus needs to shift to pre-birth to preschool if we're going to make the great difference. And this was shown up in the news stories last week, where it was all the attention was on closing the gap in terms of educational attainment. Closing the gap is a great thing to do. We absolutely should do what we can. Even better is preventing the gap from ever opening. But we wait around until there's a gap and then try to think, how can we close it? Instead of, how do we not have the gap appear in the first place? And in order for the gap not to appear in the first place, we need to pay very careful attention to pre-birth to preschool. From our perspective, that also means preconception health. But I don't want to drag that out. I put it in here. But yes, there's plasticity, and it is never too late to help a child, obviously. It's also never too early. And I think that it is crucial for us to remember and begin to act on the declaration from the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government that we value preventative spending. Because we say that, but thus far, if you did a hard analysis of where the money is going and where the attention is going, it's not on primary prevention. And so in a sense, I shouldn't have to tell you what you've already publicly proclaimed. Preventive spending could and should be the priority, but that means really doing it. You can make up for things that went wrong in the first place, but there's no such thing as a second chance to make a good first impression. And the impression that we make on children's brains, on their emotions, on their learning, on their lives, we have one chance to get that foundation right. And if we do, their trajectory is good. If we don't, we're going to keep spending extraordinary amounts of time, effort, and money on trying to catch up and redress what we failed to do in the first place.
Dr. Buston.
Institute of Health and Wellbeing at Glasgow University. It's wonderful today all this talk about prevention, but also we need to look more downstream at the more curative things as well and the more specific things in the context of the wider societal things. And it was a pleasure to hear Professor Marmot and Zahari Burns talk as they did. I think daycare, yes, I'm not an expert on that, but also the parents. And I couldn't leave here today without putting in a word for the parent attachment, parenting interventions and so on. And it ties in with the other issue of reach. And being a researcher, we do need to look into more who we're reaching with the kinds of interventions that are being implemented and really better understand what kind of effect they're having on the most disadvantaged. Hardly any research work looks at the most disadvantaged, because it's challenging, because interventions can't always reach the most disadvantaged. And I think that's what we need to think about more. And in terms of my own work, it's just popped up in my head, all the prison work that I've done in the past. Young fathers in Pullman was mentioned, I think, by Harry Burns. I mean, they're literally a captive audience, these guys in Pullman. Do a bit of work with them on parenting interventions, monitor it, see how that's working. That's a huge thing that can be done for relatively little spend. And I think it's just useful to say that in the context of the wider things that we're talking about also, which is wonderful.
Thank you. Dr. Hill.
Yeah, just to come back to the issue of thinking about Professor Frank's point about the need to measure and monitor what's going on in terms of early childhood development, and also thinking about Ben Farrugia's point about the fact there can be resistance from within communities. I think it is important to recognise the role of good parenting and attachment, but I think that it's an area that's quite difficult for us to tackle from a policy perspective. Certainly, where there are interventions that can be offered, I'm fully supportive of those, but I think those interventions are only ever likely to reach a very small proportion of the population, and I think that Professor Marmot made a really good point about the fact that, in the end, parents from less advantaged circumstances struggle to do what they know is a component of good parenting because of all of the other pressures they're subjected to. So I think we have to be realistic about the extent to which policy can really address that, while also acknowledging that we should do what we can. And for that reason, I think that I also think there's some risk if we only focus on those people that we regard as poor parents, that we are reinforcing a sense of blame for those communities, and that's often associated then with resistance to efforts to measure and monitor, because those are seen as reinforcing this idea that these disadvantaged communities are responsible for their own difficulties. I think one of the real strengths of the monitoring instrument that Professor Frank is talking about is that it's not... the way it's used is not associated with placing blame on specific schools, that the point of the instrument is not to measure how those schools are performing, it's to measure the capacity of those children when they reach P1 and P2, and that's primarily used as a marker of need. That the point of measuring that is to say which communities have the greatest need in terms of investment in early years education. So I think that's a really positive way that instrument can be used. And to come back to the point about workforce, which you were asking us to discuss, I think the advantage of looking at early childhood education, preschool education, is that there's a real opportunity there for policymakers to implement what Sir Michael Marmot refers to as proportionate universalism. As Bob Doris mentioned, there is early child care provided for which almost all children are eligible at the moment. At present, the emphasis is on childcare. What I would be asking for is a shift to seeing that more as an opportunity for early child education, and that alongside that we invest in the people that are providing care in those contexts and that we provide them with adequate support, both so that they are fully qualified in childhood development and they're able to provide both to help children, particularly from disadvantaged backgrounds, overcome the disadvantages associated with growing up in an environment where they may not have strong parenting, but also so we're investing in supporting those people to provide the most nurturing, caring environment possible, and one where there's continuity of care. And that I think, is a policy opportunity that it would be a shame for the government to miss.
Just to add my own looked-after element to some of that as well. And during the discussions around the Children and Young People Act, there was some debate as those proposals were being developed about the impact on children who are looked after at home or with kinship carers, with the provision of basically a full-time carer elsewhere, essentially, and the building of that attachment relationship rather than with their primary caregiver. And I suppose that's kind of a partial answer to your question and the need to do that. And I suppose building on Dr. Sarah Hill's point, I suppose, in that list of things that perhaps we could wish some of that early years workforce could do is perhaps working with parents to be able to provide those nurturing qualities that we need to see that they can then build on themselves, rather than just providing a different space entirely in which we can build those.
I suppose that the point that Professor Frank made is that if the finance and resources are determined by population levels and not necessarily focus on need, then how does it impact? How do you get that appropriate universalism? Dr. Sher.
I hope that my colleague Ellen Sinclair will say something about the experience in the Netherlands, because it speaks to this. But Sweden was mentioned by Sir Michael and Sir Harry. And one of the things that's different about Sweden is that there is a universal service for parents of babies and very young children that it has a near universal reach. They don't spend a lot of time talking about hard to reach parents, because it's not a concept that resonates there, because it's something which is welcome and valued and attractive. But what they do is there are opportunities, and there's a sort of normal schedule that's just how life is, where parents and babies show up 12 times between birth and age two. And what's true for them, good, bad, or indifferent, is assessed. And when something is found that's a concern, there is a transition, more or less seamless, to getting the support and help that's needed to deal as early as the concern is raised. And you just do that over and over and over again. So the issue of there being a big gap when they're 3 years old or going into school at primary doesn't happen. And it doesn't happen because it was prevented from happening. And I just wanted to use the Swedish example as a very clear one of how it really works in the real world to make prevention a normal feature of what government supports and what parents sign up for and participate in freely, happily, and gratefully.
On the Sinclair on the Dutch.
Okay. I can partly held back because we've had so much sort of policy tourism going on, visiting different countries. But and I'm trying to find a way of describing why I became a fan of Netherlands in 30 words. It goes in a few things, which is when I've talked to about supporting parents very frequently in Britain, people convert that. You mean we're intervening. We're making an intervention. We're stepping over the line. In Holland, I've spent mornings in the most deprived part of Holland where people are coming up to all their regular appointments because they do it from birth right up to school age, and they have about 12, 14 appointments, and they come because this is a help to them. And they know the nurse, they know the doctor. I also do management work in Holland, and without talking about the early years, and this time last year, a very successful business person was telling me about his family and how the nurses had been helping him with a particular issue with their twins. It was universal. It was there for everyone. It was non-stigmatised. It was part of what everybody did. What worries me about health inequalities and early years is that I fear that we're getting to a position where we think that help with children is what we do for the feckless, rather than for the population of people who are suffering. And I live in a very leafy part of Glasgow, and if I go down my street and I give you the catalogue of problems of middle-class children, it's terrifying. These people are struggling, these children have struggled, some of them are now dead, others are self-harming. We have a serious issue here across our society, and we are in danger of putting it into a corner, whether it's about childcare and it's about the feckless. Actually, it's how we operate as a society. And if I can disagree with Sarah Hill, there are very, very clear ways of doing this. And the family centres that they have in Holland with the mother and baby wellbeing has been going for 100 years or more. It's well established, it's cherished, and it's made a very big difference in Holland, because on most international indicators, those that are doing best on child wellbeing are actually as Holland by a long way.
May I just ask, Ellen, is it do families have to access those centres, or is it an optional extra? I suppose I'm just trying to get to some of the sort of cultural elements that underpins
it. It almost doesn't apply. People come because they want to come and they see it as a help. But if you do not make a few appointments, someone will come and knock at your door to find out why have you not come. So there's a long stop. But actually, it's a long way before you get to the long stop, because there is such an overwhelming acceptance that this is a help.
Richard Simpson.
I think that the point that Professor Frank's making about monitoring is really, you know, looking at where we've got to with these early years is very important. I mean, this is not new. As I said in the last session, we've had family centres, Sure Start, Home Start, nursery education at 3 and 4. We've had that now for some of it, to for 10 or 12 years. But we don't know, actually, whether that's really worked. There's been some research, but not a lot. Can I ask anyone here to tell us what we should stop measuring so that we can measure what's appropriate? Because we seem to measure just about everything that moves in terms of process, in terms of inputs and throughputs and outputs, but not outcomes. So, you know, if people can tell us what we can do that, we can then maybe afford to have what is a, sounds like a very simple measure at five to say, yeah, well, in this area, in this local authority area, with that program, this seems to be working. With that program, it's not. And therefore, we stop doing it.
Any takers?
Well, Richard, I know that you kind of know the answer to this because I know that you are a researcher and a physician. But I'll just say that quite a lot of useless hand-wringing occurs in Scotland because the annual report on health inequalities, which is technically superb, by far best in the world. Technically, nothing wrong with it. I say that as an epidemiologist. But of the 11 health outcomes analyzed again and again, 6 years in a row, all but one occur far too late in life to be influenced by any policy within 5 years because they're based on deaths and hospitalizations that are predominantly past age 50 or 60. I'm not saying that those people shouldn't have the best possible preventive care and clinical care. I'm just saying that that will not direct you towards the upstream drivers, the determinants of health, because you're doing tombstone epidemiology. You know, and the one measure that it looks at for early life is low birth weight babies, the main driver of which, prematurity, was very carefully reviewed last year by a world-class team and published in The Lancet, in which they pointed out that we know so little about preventing prematurity that we could only reduce it by 5% of its current levels, even if we implemented everything we knew. So let's not measure stuff we can't change. Let's not wring our hands about stuff that's too far gone. Let's focus on things that we could change. In Perth, Australia, they managed to change the EDI scores. This is the instrument we piloted in East Lothian. In less than 5 years, they massively shifted deprived communities' EDI scores by putting in place reading programs, activity programs, parent-child programs within walking distance of people's homes. It's not rocket science.
Does Alison Leslie's tombstone figures not, you know, not lead us to, you know, child mortality, you know, some debate there, or indeed, you know, where we stand out, where we have got a high number of school-aged children still, you know, can we not use these figures to direct? And
interesting enough, with sort of mortality data, it's actually the other way around, because the deaths that you can make a difference in are the older children. The majority of children who die in Scotland are aged under 6 months. Half of all children who die in Scotland are a year and under, and a lot of that are around sort of congenital sort of conditions at birth and so on, things that we don't know enough about yet and we can't do a lot about. The ones that we can actually do things about, which are the deaths that where we really sort of are in a sort of shameful position in relation to the rest of Europe, are sort of, you know, trauma deaths, which are sort of, you know, road traffic accidents, suicides, deaths from reckless behaviour, deaths where there's an element of alcohol or sort of or drugs involved. These are the ones that we can do something about. These are the modifiable ones that sort of when you're looking at there. And I think, again, one of the things is, if you take, for example, things like teenage suicide, which gets a lot of publicity just now, the problem is we don't know enough. We don't know the relationship between the pre-existing and predisposing factors in a child's life and circumstances and the precipitating factors, whether it is sort of, you know, bullying or something in their circumstances. We don't know enough about that. We don't know what we've not looked careful enough at, you know, what is happening in other countries where the rate of teenage suicide is significantly lower, and what's working there that we're not doing here. And it's an area which is really under researched. I think is going to be sort of one of the next areas we need to sort of think about as a country, get to understand the problem more before we start putting solutions in.
Some of, you know, a disproportionate number will have been in care. a disproportionate number indeed. Will be identified on child protection registers. Yes. We know the number of children who are on child protection registers who are suffering abuse, violent abuse, etc. And I suppose, you know, where are they? How does that trigger a reaction? How does that trigger the services? Are the services there, you know, to help these children? Children first said in mental health services and child counsellors, only 10 in Scotland. And yes, we've got 1,000 every year on the child protection register.
Yeah.
So we have the information, negative or not, the outcomes, are we acting appropriately to make a difference in the lives of these children? Ben.
Sorry. I was just going to say that I think what I'm hearing sort of slightly implicit in what you were saying there is the issue of thresholds, which I think are a reality for lots of communities. You know, how bad do things have to get before the intervention is provided? And I do use the word intervention consciously, Alan, because I think that is actually often what it is. And that is a concern. I think mental health is a good example there of where things have been pushed into a sort of CAMS lens, which is a highly specialist service, really, for things. And we have a sense that the people have to reach that threshold, when actually mental health services should be about well-being, a much lower base. So,
Jonathan Sher.
Alison Leslie is right that there's a lot that we don't know, but there's also a good deal that we do know. And I think one of the subjects which hasn't been explicitly stated that connects some of these topics is the issue of child maltreatment, meaning abuse and neglect and growing up with domestic violence or in toxic, violent environments. And it makes a difference in very long-term health, and that there's a whole raft of studies which are retrospective, that generally are classified as the ACE studies, adverse childhood experience studies. Looking back, mostly I have to say from middle class and up people, at the adverse effects in childhood, the maltreatment or other adversity they encountered. And the essence of what they've said is that the more adverse childhood experience you've had in your very earliest years, the higher the rates of cancer, of heart disease, of early death, that the connection between what happens in the very earliest time, in the first 1,001 days of life, has a lifelong effect, and if it's negative, a life shortening and life debilitating and life illness-producing effect. So we do know something about what causes it. But for example, one of the things that is rarely mentioned, or perhaps because it's not understood, is that the majority of child maltreatment, abuse, neglect, domestic violence, the children affected by that most are the children birth to one. I mean, there's this sort of image of child abuse as being something with a 7-year-old being smacked around. But in fact, that's not where it starts. It starts in those first 1,001 days of life. And so if we want to reduce teen suicides, and we want to reduce mental health problems, and we want to reduce longer-term physical health problems and costs, the time to do that is those first 1,001 days of life. And even going back to the preconception part is important. You know, one thing that we do not do in Scotland, I'd like to say one good thing and one not so good thing. One not so good thing is that for all we talk about parenting and are willing to blame parents when things go awry, we do not, as a society, take seriously preparing and supporting the next generation of parents. Again, it's the same habit. We wait until things go wrong and then we react, instead of getting it right from the beginning and preparing the next generation in a healthy way. The good thing I want to say is that attachment, I think, is indicative of something that's really worked well. When I came to Scotland 9 years ago, the only time attachment was ever talked about was when it went horribly wrong and was a psychiatric problem that needed intense special treatment. Now, only 9 years later, attachment is talked about as, and increasingly being dealt with as, something that is about everybody, as Alan said. It isn't just some marginal issue for those people over there. Attachment, the basic bond between a baby and parent, is something that doesn't respect socioeconomic boundaries. If getting it right for any people, for any socioeconomic group, is crucially important, and that's finally been learned. And so we are now acting on that understanding, not waiting for it to become a psychiatric disorder for a few children. And that's commendable, as is this whole inquiry on early years.
Thank you. Dr. Buston.
Can I just give a quick mention as well of a study we're doing in my department? It's a three-armed RCT called Thrive, which involves enhanced triple P for babies. It involves mellow babies and care as usual. And it's not going to be reporting back fully till 2017, which I know isn't great for you guys. But the outcomes, one of the outcomes is going to be child maltreatment. And totally take your point there about parenting interventions and stigma. And it's such a hugely political thing. But it shouldn't be. Most parents want to be good parents, and if there's help there and you're being recruited during pregnancy, then it's important to monitor what is happening and hopefully adapt things so that the women who really feel that they want and need this kind of help can access it, and we'll be measuring it, you know, really thoroughly and properly and so on. So it's quite an important trial.
Linda Dunn.
On the issue of parenting, I wonder why we haven't considered, perhaps, as in Scandinavia countries, many parents, carers, might want to stay at home with the baby for the first 2 years, but they have to return to work because of the poverty side of things, because they need to earn a living. You know, that would be a universal measure, that if people could have the choice, should they want to stay at home, that they would maybe still have half pay or what have you, and that would give them the luxury and the enjoyment of staying at home and bonding with their child. And that, you know, I'm all for the workforce development, but I equally think, you know, many parents would enjoy staying at home and being with their child, and, you know, it links in with the attachment thing as well.
Childcare, to put those two together, in Finland, if you choose to stay at home, thanks to the rural party arguing the case, then you can get paid the equivalent of what it would cost the state to put you into the child into a nursery, so that you're staying at home and you get the money for it. Whereas we think it's a good thing to put children in a nursery and put the subsidy. Is it not a good thing that people look after their own children? That just shows you there's a very strange lot of thinking going on.
Who goes to parenting classes?
For driving cars and operating television controls now, but we don't do it for people.
It's not a one-to-one. It's a, yeah.
That's the point. We don't do it.
Right. Okay. Richard Lyle.
Yes, I found this discussion very good, and I could cover many points. My mother-in-law was Dutch. Went to Holland many a time, and I found that actually Holland was well in front of us in many things, and but also their benefit levels were much higher than what they are here. Daycare 0 to 3, I would say it's first of all it's parents, local playgroups, and then it's grandparents. My daughter recently had another baby. My grandson was 2 last Friday, and his development, I put him to sleep by singing to him. Which is basically a situation, but he loves reading books and he loves and doing jigsaws, etc. And I can see the development in the last couple of months of how he has developed. But sometimes I feel as though we feel that kids should be put on too fast. But again, the question I really want to ask you, convener, and I think it was pointed out in the first session, but it really wasn't developed. We've got a minimum wage. We've got a living wage. When I worked, when I was self-employed, I always believed if I earned £10 an hour, I was making a decent amount of money. Minimum wage and a living wage is still under £300 a week. I dealt with a case yesterday where the person, because of certain income benefit levels, their housing benefit had fallen, but their income had went up and down like a yo-yo, and basically they've fallen into housing arrears. And we got it sorted out yesterday. But basically, the situation I want to ask, what would happen if we actually, and you see employers on the television saying, oh no, we can't pay this wage. But if we actually raised wages to a decent level that people could actually afford and also stay at home. I actually stopped my wife working many years ago to look after her kids. I've got two great kids and two great jobs, and basically I think that but I was able to do that because I went out and was able to work. I was never unemployed. I was lucky that way, although I was made redundant twice. But if we developed and increased the wages, the income for people, so that people had a decent wage, would that not lift people out of poverty, or is that being simplistic? That's a question I want to ask.
Professor Frank.
So, I think Professor Marmot said this, but I'll say it again. You have to do that, but it's not enough. You have to do that because, and there's a great new report from Harvard University. You can get it through Graham Allen's website, the English MP, which explains in very plain language how a childhood in poverty changes the way your brain and particularly your stress response functions. And it turns it on, it can turn it on in such a fashion that you can't turn it off. And it starts a process of chronic disease development prematurely. So given that, you have no choice. If you want to have a humane Scotland, if you want the kind of Scotland that it seems everyone in this room wants, you have to get rid of child poverty or get it down to the levels that we heard Professor Marmot describing. But you will still remain having, you still have to deal with elements of culture, including elements of the culture as it influences the way parents behave, not all, but some. And you'll have to deal with the fact that communities are not all equally able to support parents and give them opportunities to do things with their kids that are accessible. So you've got to do that. We've got to do that. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying here. We've got to get rid of child poverty, just as we need to get rid of pensioner poverty. That's a dreadful situation, but that's not what we're here to talk about today. But don't think it'll just fix the problem. It's like universal health care, which we also can in Canada enjoy for not quite as long as the UK. You've got to do it if you want a humane society, but it won't level the entire playing field of life.
Anyone else? Yes, Alison.
Can I just come back to a point that was raised in the earlier session about child protection and about the rules and regulations and the way that they affect, we react to children? Because I think it sort of picks up on what Professor Frank was saying about alongside initiatives to sort of, you know, redress sort of financial inequalities in society. We also need to be looking at, you know, how we ensure children have the most positive experiences outside the home if they're not getting them in the home. And how awful must it be if you are 3-year-old and what you learn at your nursery or daycare centre is if you fall over, sort of, you know, no one is going to comfort you. You'll be sat down and someone will be sent for to come and put the bandage on your knee or give you a hug or change your whatever, because of all the sort of, you know, rules and regulations around sort of, you know, what's called child protection. Now, I spend the vast majority of my professional life reviewing and investigating the cases where things go terribly wrong and children die as a result of maltreatment. And because of the things I've seen over the years, there is no one more hawkish about child protection than I am. But frankly, I think in terms of the culture and the ethos that's grown up around about it, you know, we have gone completely bonkers as a society. It is ridiculous, the kind of things we've talked about earlier, that people can't hug a child, that people can't reach out to a child, particularly when a child's in distress. And I think that there is something about sort of, you know, working with sort of, you know, people who are delivering that valuable job of caring for children, whether it's sort of as sort of extended family, whether it's sort of in care settings, whether it's sort of daycare, nurses, or whatever, to sort of change the message. And I think one of the things, the simplest things we can do is to actually stop talking about child protection. If you think of the analogy of data protection, as soon as we started talking about data protection, we lost a sense about what the legislation was about, which the legislation is actually about enabling you to share sort of data in a way that sort of is respectful of people's privacy. And the more we talk about child protection, what we're creating is this sense of we've got to sort of take children and sort of, you know, put them someplace sort of safe away from everyone. What we actually should be about is sort of child nurturing. And I think we've got to, one of the simple things we can do is actually change the language there.
We're coming to a close of this session, and I know that committee members have get pressures elsewhere, but we've got lots of good written evidence from you all, but obviously, unless any of the committee members are pressing, Rhoda?
Sorry, I was trying to get in earlier, but it's, I suppose specifically, and it follows on from what Alice and Leslie were saying about submissions we've had about looked after children, and there, I mean, we've talked about generally about children and their life chances. When you take looked after children out of the equation, suddenly life chances, you know, it becomes hugely different and very, very negative. And I suppose, given time and that, what can we do differently about looked after children that actually changes that life chances? Because it seems to be the moment that badge goes on to them, their life changes are kind of disastrously impacted.
I suppose I wish I had a nice simple answer to that question, but of course there isn't. And I think the parliamentary inquiry into decision-making around looked after children that took place in 2013, I think, kind of opened up the wide complexity of that question, of that sort of simple question, what can we do? And I suppose I would probably echo some of what Jonathan and Alan have been saying and my fellow colleagues here today, which is that actually it is about the children and young people, of course, but it's actually about saying often there is a younger sibling on the way going to be coming, and it's about getting in systems in place to make sure that the life for that child who's going to be born and going to be grown up is going to be improved. Absolutely, we need better services. I'm a big advocate for better services for looked after children. Targeted services and a wider sense of universal access to universal services help to support those. I mean, I'm very conscious, if we're thinking just about health, that for some looked after children, they have access to a LAC nurse and some don't. And that's not even a matter of whether they're placement type, it's where they are in Scotland. And that is perhaps a concern. And self-reported by them, it's a fantastic service. You know, it's somebody who they can trust. It's an attachment relationship that we've been talking about, an important one, and somebody who can support them with their health. So there are those interventions that I think would be good. But, you know, do we do enough with the families that we know are going to be having more children?
Dr. Sher.
I'd like to give a very specific response about looked after children, which is that what we know is that care leavers are disproportionately represented among early parents. Many more care leavers will have children very early than the population as a whole. And we know that they're disproportionately represented among parents who will have children who will become looked after themselves. There's a non-genetic intergenerational problem here. But what we don't do at this point, and what we could do, is work much more intensively with looked after children care leavers as prospective parents and do the preconception health things that are needed so that they, first of all, can make an informed, empowered choice about whether they want to become parents at all, and if so, when, and when being contingent upon what's true of them in their lives so that they're ready to become good parents, because they want, like everybody else, they want to have healthy, thriving, happy babies, and they want to have a happy parenting relationship with those babies. But we're not doing anything to prepare them. We keep dealing with them as individuals, as opposed to understanding that in addition to being individuals, they also are parents and prospective parents. That's something we could do now that would make an intergenerational difference.
Very quickly. Sorry. Yes, certainly.
Yeah, it's the newer lanes pilot in Glasgow, which I think mentioned briefly earlier, is astoundingly interesting because it simultaneously works with the birth family and works with the fostering family and the child in both settings, and simultaneously plans, is the child going to move to the foster family to adopt, or will it go back because they're trying to put intensive help and support into the birth family to see within a period of time if that can be a safe home? Because at the moment we are constrained by the nature of law and healthcare, and the decision-making that goes on there is not the kind of decision-making that goes on in a child's life and attachment. And what the pilot is doing, based on very good work that's going on in the States, is trying to put that in into Glasgow just now. I think it's astounding.
We have come to the sort of the end, but I'm happy if you know, if people want to leave us with a thought, you know, that you know, must do or whatever, then I'll give you that opportunity now. I ask you to see this as a live process, so what you've heard today and what you've discussed today can be followed up by email, and we'd be happy to receive additional. You know, does anyone want to leave us with a final thought? Or I'm not going to encourage you, Jonathan. I see you looking over.
I've got my hands pretty good. Don't see me raising it.
Well, can I, on behalf of the committee, thank you all for your the time you've given us this morning, and we'll look forward to engaging with you in the future on these difficult and challenging issues. Thank you very much for your time this morning, coming along. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.